Our NASCAR Busch Series coverage at Phoenix being brought to you by FreeCreditReport.com. Stay on top of your credit score and credit report at FreeCreditReport.com. Here in Phoenix, Arizona, in the shadows of the Estrella Mountains, getting set for NASCAR Busch Series action. Next to the last event of the season, folks, it is a one-mile racetrack. Going for 200 miles, it's 200 laps, pit road speed 45 miles an hour. There's the pit window. Can you make it halfway, or do you want to make it halfway on tire wear? We'll talk about that later on. There's the banking, folks. It is two different degrees of banking in turns one and two. It's 11 degrees, three and four, 9 degrees. A different radius of turn. And oh, by the way, in the middle of the back straightaway, there's a dog leg. So it is certainly a challenging racetrack here for the NASCAR Busch Series drivers who are trying to possibly get a win. A lot of agendas up for grabs here. Some of the Busch-only drivers trying to win a race. Some of the guys trying to get a ride for 2008. Could we lock up a Busch owner's title here today? All that coming up here in just a moment. Meanwhile, let's go down trackside to get the command to crank them up.
Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome back your Grand Marshal, Dennis Burke, as he delivers the most famous words in motorsports.
Gentlemen, start your engines.
Crank them up, gang. Crank them up.
Command has been given, and 43 of NASCAR's finest, NASCAR Busch Series drivers, getting set for 200 laps today. 15 of these guys, by the way, will run 500 kilometers, 312 laps in the NASCAR Nextel Cup event coming up on Sunday. Take a look at our starting grid. Clint Bowyer, who dominated here back in April, becomes the 20th different pole sitter in 2007, his sixth career pole, and beside him, Scott Wimmer, fourth time he has started on the front row this year. And while you wait to see where your favorite driver is starting, let's visit with our in-race reporter, the driver of the car number 21, the AutoZone Chevrolet, Kevin Harvick, who starts back in sixth today.
Hey, Kevin Harvick, Rusty Wallace, ESPN, you got us?
Pit stall 12, Billy.
Hey, Kevin, Rusty Wallace, ESPN, you got us?
I got you.
Hey, Kevin, you won here in the trucks, the Busch Series, and the Cup. Man, it looks like you really love this place. What's your chances today with this car?
I have a hard time hearing you guys. We've got a good car here. AutoZone Chevrolet has been really good since we unloaded the site. Last night, the race kind of got away from me as we got towards the end. We've got to make the right adjustments as we get through the first part of the race.
All right, buddy. Thanks for talking to us.
All right, the man will be calling the shots for Kevin today. You talk about six wins this year in that 21 car. Shane Wilson, let's talk with Shane.
Hey, Shane Wilson. Andy Petrie, you got a copy?
Yeah, 10-4, Andy. Go ahead.
Hey, Shane. This is a tricky little racetrack, and it's not like a lot of tracks we run on. What are the challenges for getting a car right here?
Well, you know, it starts out with 1 and 2, and 3 and 4, so, you know, the driver has to compromise and try to get the car, you know, a happy medium. And someone that's driven here a lot like Kevin, you know, it's pretty, you know, he can help us a lot, get the car better, and he's going to be making the right adjustments at the end of the day.
Well, 10-4, good luck with it, guys, and have a great race.
All right, Shane Wilson, what a job he's done. 9 wins a year ago for Kevin Harvick on his way to a championship in the series, and 6 wins in 12 starts this year in the 21 car. Harvick trying to pick up win number 7. We'll take a quick break and come back and visit with our pit road reporters in just a moment. Back at Phoenix International Raceway Field now, one of the pace cars has pulled away. Our onboard camera, as we told you, Clint Bowyer, the pole sitter, BB&T Chevrolet, David Reagan, starts 12th, the Discount Tires Ford, Mike Wallace, 23rd, the Geico Chevy, Kevin Harvick, our in-race reporter, you've already heard from, his AutoZone Chevy, starts 6th, Richard Johns, 42nd, the FreeCreditReport.com Ford, Scott Wimmer, outside front row, the Holiday Inn Chevrolet, Marcus Ambrose, 38th, the Kingsford Charcoal Ford, and David Ruderman starts 15th, the Memphis winner in the Aaron's Toyota. Rusty, this track, we talk about the tunnel turn at Pocono. Everyone talks about the funnel at Phoenix. What are they talking about entering turn one?
Well, you get down to turn one, Jerry, the racetrack seems like it narrows up to one groove. It's pretty dirty in the outside lane, so you don't want to go in there side by side. And Andy, you know, you can really tear a car up right off the bat if you try to get too aggressive going in that corner.
What do you do to get your car ready to make that first corner? I mean, when you're coming to the green right here, what are you doing?
Well, right now, the key thing going on right now is you don't get too aggressive. I'm getting ready, getting my tires warmed up, getting the motor cleared out. But if I make a pass after the start-finish line, I'm good to go there. But if it gets too tight, I need to back out, man, because it's the first lap of the race, and I don't want to throw it away.
Turn one, lap one can be treacherous in Phoenix. A lot of things can happen when they take the green flag. It really funnels down, and here they come, Clint Bowyer and Wimmer, as the green flag waves in NASCAR Busch competition. Bowyer slides up in the high line, will take the position away in front of Wimmer. The challenge now for third position.
See, one of the key things, Scott Wimmer got right behind Clint Bowyer, single file coming in on the exit of turn two. And that's the thing you got to do, because that top lane is really not burned in good for race on the second lane yet.
Well, Scott Wimmer needs to lead a lap in this 29 car for this owner's championship. They've got points to worry about, and he's losing a little ground with Clint, so it's going to be hard for him to get these 5 points early.
Harvick is there in position. They're mixing it up back in the pack. Their sixth car is David Ragan, the leading rookie of the year contender.
Jerry, one key thing about this racetrack, the tire pressures they start with are very, very low. Only about 12 pounds of air in the left-hand tires, about 30 pounds of air in the right side. And Andy, as a driver, it takes a while to get this car up to speed. It moves around a lot, and you can see a lot of drivers around that kind of dicing around trying to get in position.
Does that car change a lot on you as these tires are coming up, and how long does it take for that to happen?
It's going to take about 5 or 6 laps to get the car up to speed where it needs to be. Because right now they're slipping and sliding, holding on for dear life until the temperature in the tires come up, until that pressure comes up also.
27 car is Robbie Gordon. The 17 you see on the high side, that's Matt Kenseth, who won this race a year ago.
Okay,
up front,
okay.
Here we go.
Here?
We told you maybe some teammates, some teamwork there. And the 29 car goes by to lead a lap, and that's very valuable.
I thought it was going to be hard for this to happen because that 5 car was pushing these guys so hard, but they got it worked out, and this 29 car gets to lead a lap.
Jamie?
Well, that pass was all part of the plan. Mike Dillon, the spotter for Clint Bowyer, came over the radio and said, hey, man, now would be a good time to let Scott Wimmer lead if you can. Remember, you guys, like you're talking about, that owner's championship on the line. He's going to get 5 bonus points for leading this lap. It's all teamwork, like you said.
And now if they're going to play nice, they've got to let Clint Bowyer get back in front. So that's going to be kind of tricky. So you let him have it. Now is he going to give it back to him?
Well, he'll probably give it back to him pretty shortly when he gets time to do it. You know, he doesn't want to get up real quick and, you know, get caught on the outside lane and maybe go to the back. So when the time is right, he'll do it.
Again, coming into today, the owner's championship still up for grabs. Yes, Carl Everett locked up the driver's point title last week at Texas. And here's the 17 car of Kenseth. And by the way, the guy who's second in owner's points is the 20 car. It's Joe Gibbs Racing car and Denny Hamlin trying to take that spot away.
Well, guys, the driver's championship's locked up. And there he goes. Clint Bowyer back. Favor paid back. Scott Wimmer in the second place. And that was pretty predictable, Andy.
Okay, so now what are they going to do? They're going to go back and race each other hard. So if the 29 car is better than the two, he's going to go ahead and now pass him back for the lead.
Well, now it's legal to do that.
Right.
You know, the best man wins right now. The best man takes the lead and has the fastest car. But these Richard Childress cars have been so strong here at Phoenix, Arizona. This 2-car of Bowyer and the 29 of Wimmer, very strong here.
Let's don't forget about the 21 of Harvick, too. He's back there at about 5th spot. He's catching these guys. He's already moved up a spot to 4th. He'll be there pretty soon.
Yeah. This guy always runs good. Kevin Harvick, we talked earlier about, he's won here in the trucks. He's won here in the Busch Series. He's won here in the Cup Series. This is one driver that flat gets around this racetrack really good.
Only driver to win in all 3 of NASCAR's major series is here at Phoenix International Raceway. How about Dario Franchitti making his 3rd ever NASCAR Busch start? He's in the 42 car. Franchitti qualified impressively in the 8th spot.
That was a great qualifying run, but he's getting some good hard lessons from some veterans right here. You see how the 20 car Denny Hamlin passed him, and you got Matt Kenseth on the outside. He's probably going to let these guys go and then try to just learn from them.
More on Franchitti. Here's Shannon.
Yeah, Dario Franchitti competed on this track before, an open wheel. Guys, there's a caution on the track.
Going in.
Crash on the racetrack. First caution of the day coming in on lap number 8, the 72 car DJ Kennington. His Dodge has had some heavy contact with the barrier there. And the 56 of Frank Cryer also involved.
not sure exactly what happened here. It looks like maybe he got some contact, the 72 car, DJ Kennington.
Man,
Meyer gets it, right into it, too.
Andy, it looks like he had contact on the entry of the corner. And, boy, that's a real volatile part of the corner. You're running over 160 miles an hour there. And if you get tapped on entry, it's a big crash. And obviously, that's what's happened here.
Wow. Look at that.
Wow.
I mean, we could see the hole underneath of that car there. That thing was awful high. Thank God again for the soft walls. We've talked about this many times, folks.
Richard John's onboard camera right behind
him. Boy, there. Come on, go low, go low, go low. Good job.
Well, how important is the spotter here? Yeah.
Hard contact right there. The spotter did a good job with the 25 car getting through this. No chance to save it on that.
Guys, that just appears. That was a major, you know, problem with Frank Cryer. He just got in a corner so deep, didn't get on the brakes enough, and boy, well, he got into the back. DJ Kennington, awful hard.
Yeah, good to see DJ climbing out of the car. Safety cruiser there. That safer barrier did its job. The driver walks away. Back with more in just a moment. Welcome back to the Arizona Travel 200. These aerial shots, high above Phoenix International Raceway, courtesy of our good friends at Goodyear, the official tire of NASCAR, helping NASCAR drivers get to the finish line for over 50 years. Under caution for the first time of the day, and the guy who's certainly been the man of the year, although he didn't run for the championship, Kevin Harvick, six times in that 21 car he has won out of the 12 times he has driven. That's batting 500 in anybody's book, and that's pretty awesome for Kevin Harvick. Let's speak with Harvick right now, who sits back and forth in the 21 car.
Hey, Kevin Harvick, Rusty Wallace, ESPN, you got us?
Gotcha.
Hey, buddy, what's the track doing right now? A little crashing going on early here. Pretty slick out there?
Hey, the track was really slick in Cup happy hour, and our car was a little loose over there. Over here, we're a little bit tight up off, so just lacking a little bit of grip front tire-wise right now. But, you know, this place is just hard to pass on, and you gotta get in there and gouge a little bit. So I don't know what happened at the back there.
Hey, Kevin, speaking of hard to pass, the way your car's handling you, where you've been running here, where do you expect to make most of your passes out on this track here in Phoenix?
I think the best place to pass is if you can get through the middle one and two and get in the throttle before the other guys. So, old Rick Crilly always used to tell me here, you got to turn before they do in order to get up underneath them up off the corner. So that's what we try to do, and the best spot's usually over here in one and two.
All right, buddy, we'll check in with you later.
Hey, Shane Wilson, Andy Petrie, you got us?
At 10-4, Andy, I got you.
Hey, Shane, you know, the last couple of weeks we've seen a lot of guys searching for lines out there, running that high line right up next to the wall. What do you expect to see here?
You know, I think here, you know, kind of what Kevin said, you know, we're going to, you know, stick to the line that he runs and try to keep her on the bottom. And that's where we're going to get our passes made and also protect our position here. You know, you get up high sometimes, you might lose a spot or two before you figure it out.
10-4. We're going to try to get us some green flag racing here, and you guys are already starting to pass cars, so you look good. Good luck.
Andy.
For more information on track conditions, log on to ESPN.com, search word safety. And again, we are under caution for the first time today. Lap number 8, heavy contact between the 56 car, Frank Cryer, and the 72 car. That's DJ Kennington's car, who took the brunt of the blow. Driver's side into that soft wall or safer barrier. And the good news is that that soft wall did its job once again. Safety, the number one concern here in NASCAR. The driver able to walk away here in that first incident of the afternoon. 200 laps. We are 13, now 14 laps in. And Clint Bowyer, you saw earlier that Bowyer was a dominant car here in April. He led 120 of 200 laps. By the way, in this race a year ago, Bowyer led 50 laps. So he's led 170 laps the last two times he's been here in a Busch car. I'd say he's pretty good at this place.
Oh, yeah, he's really got this thing figured out. I mean, he's so good on the short tracks. And Richard Childress Racing has done such a good job, Andy, you know, getting these cars low to the ground, getting the front ends right on the track so they turn good and maneuver around.
They must have a great package because, like you say, everywhere you go, these Childress cars are at the front. Whether it's a bank racetrack or a flat racetrack, you got to kind of hand it to the engine guys, too, because they got these things where they'll go down the straightaway.
Yeah, Childress, by the way, his three cars have won 12 races in Busch competition, with Harvick winning 6, 4 for Jeff Burton and 2 for Bowyer. Bowyer's win here, of course, and at Richmond earlier in the year. Driver of the 72 car, DJ Kennington, by the way, has been checked out at the Enfield Care Center and released, so that certainly is good news. Pace car is pulled away, and here comes Clint Boyer to lead him down once again in the turn one in hot pursuit, his teammate, Scott Wimmer.
And you're going to see a lot of cars looking out, trying to make a pass real quick because they got fresh tires now. The tire pressures are up to speed.
Like Kyle Busch on the outside off turn two. Oh. Now he's looking for the lead.
Now here's a guy that's not going to be patient. We know that. He's got a big right foot. But Boyer clears him on the infield turn three. That's a key move right there.
Kyle Busch has already been one winner this weekend, having won the truck race, a NASCAR Craftsman truck race. And obviously hoping to have a very busy weekend here as the battle mixing up a little bit there. There goes the nine car by Wimmer. That is Casey Kane, and now Wimmer's teammate, Kevin Harvick, going by for position as we head to pit road and check in with Shannon Spake.
That's right. Well, Kyle Busch definitely wants to go to victory lane here today. This is his last Busch race. Caution on the track, guys.
16 car. Shannon, I apologize. We go down to Shannon and something happens on a racetrack. I think she's causing these caution flags. Greg Biffle, by the way, the only two-time winner here in NASCAR Busch competition. And boy, I thought he was going to get his first win of the year last week at Texas. He was leading with 34 laps to go and he had a tire go down. Let's see what happened to Greg.
I think he got a little help from behind coming off the corner.
And it looks like, though, as he went by there, that shot, I can barely see some damage on the right front fender of the 16 car. Looks like it's tucked under pretty hard. So they're going to have to get down pit road and get that fixed because that's really going to kill the aerodynamics.
2002 NASCAR Busch champion and two-time winner here at Phoenix, Greg Biffle, producing caution number two on the day. Welcome back to Phoenix International Raceway. Getting set for the restart here on lap number 19. After working caution for the second time today, the 16 car of Greg Biffle been on and off pit road. A little bit of sheet metal damage in the right front. He's back on the track. Here's Clint Boyer. He will lead him down in front of a very aggressive Kyle Busch in that five car.
Boy, Kyle Busch just gets a big run off of turn two down the back straight. He's right on the bumper now. Clint Boyer getting into turn three. And guys, when you come through that tri-oval in the back straightaway here, it just gives you so much momentum. It really gets you into turn three deep. You try to make the pass there. So hold on good to Boyer now.
Back in fourth position is the 21 of Kevin Harvick trying to make a move. Let's listen into his radio.
He's talking about Kyle Busch getting down low, coming through the tri-oval in the back straightaway. And when you get down low like that, man, it's, you know, it's not just grass. It's a lot of rocks and debris.
Oh, trouble again. Here's the 12 car.
All right, we spot, guys. We're down at four.
Wow, that's a lot of damage there.
Yeah, Sam Hornish Jr., the Indy 500 winner, three-time IRL champion.
Any good movement there?
Yeah, the 13 car making only his second ever Busch start. Todd Souza, a road racing specialist. Wow, look at that. That car is used up in the front.
Yeah, they're done for the day pretty much.
Boy, they had he made this race. He's made the cup race. He's done such a fantastic job. I mean, this was really shaping up to be a great race, great week for Sam Horner. He's got one shot left tomorrow in the NASCAR Nextel Cup race. Let's take a look at this replay, guys, and see what's happened here.
The 12's already sideways as he comes through here. If he spun by himself, but he got hard contact from the 13.
Looks like he got the left front tire, Andy, down on the apron. It kind of made the car real loose in that area, and that is one tough corner to hold on to when you get it loose. Once it starts getting loose, you're in trouble.
Outside, clear.
Yeah, you can clearly see that Sam was not around.
Good job.
Sam was not around anybody. He'll get accustomed to that. He'll understand what you can get away with these stock cars and what you can't.
Damage being repaired or attempting repairs on pit road. Now, a moment ago, you heard Kevin Harvick talking to the 21, talking about the 5 car. Let's see if we can go back and show you about what he was mentioning.
Well, you see right there, runs out of room. He's got the left front tire right down on the ripple strips in the dirt. And once he clears it, he's still in the throttle, guys. He hasn't got out of it because this guy, like I said earlier, big right foot. He's not scared of nothing.
I think he surprised Clint Bowyer. I don't think he knew that Kyle Busch was underneath him right there as they came through that dog leg, ran him right into the grass.
But Bowyer is still the leader. He did not get the pass. So Bowyer now has led twice for 21 laps. We're under caution for the third time a day here on lap number 23.
And there is the place that both the Seahawks and Niners would like to end up come the end of January, beginning of February. That's University of Phoenix Stadium, Glendale, just up the road from the racetrack here, where the Super Bowl will be held. And where Larry Fitzgerald's going to be playing tomorrow afternoon. Cardinals with a home game this weekend, and Fitzgerald here at the racetrack taking in the action this weekend. I assume that means their walkthrough was this morning. And we welcome you inside our pit studio with Brad Daugherty and Dale Jarrett, Alan Bestwick, for a driver in a race that just won't get going. What's it like?
Aggravating, because you really want to try to get into some rhythm and see what your race car is going to do so you can communicate back to your crew what they need to be prepared to do when you do make that pit stop. But what your car is doing for three or four or five laps is not what's going to happen at the end of 25 or 30. So you want to get in some laps here so you can tell them what the changes to be making.
Yeah, and in particular, you get to these smaller tracks. The key is qualifying, and oftentimes we don't put enough emphasis on the qualifying as you get from second place all the way back. A lot of these accidents are happening right now early in the back of the pack, so you need to be forward to stay out of the fray as best as possible. That therefore is the importance on qualifying.
So three cautions already in the Arizona Travel 200, and a little bit of cleanup work still to be done under this yellow. A lot of mess dropped out of the Sam Hornish car, as well as the other car involved in the accident up in turns 3 and 4. Todd Souza, the driver involved there. That's the mess they got to clean up. Green flag when we come back.
Tomorrow, the chase for the NASCAR Nextel Cup Series continues. It's the second to last race for the Nextel Cup Championship, and time is running out. Jeff Gordon won here in the spring from the pole. Can he repeat and basically get the edge, or maybe the points lead back? Our coverage begins on ABC at 3 o'clock Eastern Time, noon Pacific. One lap to go, working caution for the third time a day here. They've hard time getting the NASCAR Busch race started. Three cautions in the first 22 laps. This one, Todd Souza and Sam Hornish involved. Sam's car is spinning and heavily damaged. He's headed back to the garage area. Clint Bowyer, by the way, if you just joined our coverage, has led twice for 27 laps. Scott Wimmer, his teammate, 29 car, trying to win a Busch Series owner's title, was allowed to lead for a couple laps, and Bowyer took the lead back. And now it is Bowyer trying to hold off Kyle Busch. And folks, Kyle Busch has led the most laps 7 times in a Busch race this year. You don't get that lap leader distinction by being not being very aggressive, but he certainly is.
Oh, he's very, very aggressive. You saw the move he made coming down the back straightaway, cut through the tri-oval there and kind of threw a lot of rocks and dirt up. And the guy, these guys want to get a lot of passing done early while the tires are fresh and air pressure's up. And Andy, they just seem like they strike real hard and sometimes just a little too aggressive.
And this is the last time that Kyle Busch is going to drive this car, so I think he really wants to get a win for these guys and kind of end this relationship on a high note.
By the way, you Robbie Gordon fans, Robbie made a quick pit stop a moment ago. He's been on and off of pit road. By the way, Robbie, one of the two drivers that's won here in open wheel cars, along with Sam Hornish, that have won here in the Champ Car / IndyCar IRL. Restart. Here's Bowyer coming out of turn 4. Again, he will try to hold off Kyle Busch. Remember, Busch really gets that rocket run off of turn 2.
Been looking to the high side here on these guys in turn 1 and 2, using that momentum to go down that back stretch. Looks like he might have it this time.
Turn 2, just like we talked about, here comes the 5 car.
Going around the outside, though, on the entry of turn 3. That's a pretty tough thing to do. He's out there kind of no man's land, not a lot of grip out there, but look at this. He's got the momentum, and Bowyer's loose. Looks like he's going to get the pass.
What a pass by Kyle Busch. He goes to the high side and just goes right by the 2 car, but here comes Bowyer back, who has the short way around.
Well, Bowyer's not done yet now, but boy, that outside groove, that momentum really kicks in, and that's what you like. You see him stick his hand out the window now. Thanks a lot, Clint. I appreciate that. Pretty clear this cat wants a win.
That's just kind of an acknowledgement of, hey, yeah, that was a clean pass, and we're going to do some good racing right here. It's just kind of a, hey, thanks, guy.
Kyle Busch, third leader of the day, as we check in the garage area where Jamie is caught up with Sam Hornish Jr.
And right now the crew going to work, not looking good at this point. Sam Hornish, what happened out there, Sam?
Just got inside another car and got squeezed down there on the apron and might have got touched from behind, but early in the race, trying to get some spots back, and probably should have been a little bit more patient, but we'll keep working away at it. Got to thank all the guys that work on the Kodiak Dodge. It was a long road for them to get get out here to get running, so it's really a shame that they ended early, and hopefully we'll get back out there and get some more laps in.
Did you learn anything that you can apply to your first Cup start tomorrow?
I need to learn more, but that's where we're at right now. We'll just keep working away at it and see what happens.
All right, guys. Sam Hornish Jr., of course, with Roger Penske, announcing tonight that he will run a full-time Cup schedule in 2008.
Yeah, good to have Sam here full-time. Great job in qualifying the Cup car. You saw a moment ago the 66 car. How about Stephen Wallace, the young 20-year-old, had trouble in qualifying. And it started at the back of the packet, folks. He has already gained 19 spots. Stephen Wallace driving like his dad now, all the way up to 24th position, picking them off one by one.
Well, he just needs to keep learning. You know, he's had a tough year this year. He really has. They've been working really hard in the chassis. They spun out qualifying. But right now, looks like he's got a good car. Just got to stay patient. And boy, for a youngster, Andy, that's tough to do.
It's very hard to do for a young guy to try to have any patience, especially when you got a fast hot rod like he's got right here.
Wait a minute. It's hard for a Wallace to stay patient. I don't care how young you are, how old you are. Shannon.
During that qualifying run, and he said, we just made major changes to that car after final practice. I didn't do a mock run. I should have. He took the car back after he spun out. They made some small changes. He said the car, he thought it was going to be pretty good in the race, and as you can tell, he's climbing up the board. It's just a little loose is what Stephen is saying.
Well, right now, just like I said, this is his dad speaking. I'm telling him to be patient, because when you're on the outside, you got a car trying to pass you on the inside. If that guy on the inside makes one little mistake, he's going to slide up and hit you. So he's got to be aware of that right now.
Speaking of cars making moves, how about the 9 car of Casey Kane? Casey, a 2-time winner this year in NASCAR Busch competition. He won at Charlotte and also won back in August at Bristol Motor Speedway.
Well, this car's been really good, Andy. He's always good in these flatter racetracks, and Casey's been fast in this number 9 car every single time he gets in this thing.
I've been watching these lap times, and as soon as these guys got strung out here and kind of got settled in, he was the fastest car. He is the fastest car every single lap.
More on Casey, Jamie Little.
Well, Doc, a last-minute change for Casey Kane. His crew chief here, Mike Shiplett, in the Busch Series, had to go on over to help Patrick Carpentier, who qualified for the Cup race tomorrow. As a result, Casey Kane's Cup crew chief, of course, that's Kenny Francis, he's on top of the box. So I'm curious to see how these results are going to turn around and see if Casey can get his third win here in the Busch Series in 2007.
Yeah, that's interesting, Jamie. These guys are swapping people around with these crew chiefs, and Mike Shiplett's been the crew chief on this car all year. But it's not a bad idea to go ahead and get, your Cup crew chief over there working the Busch race. That can kind of help you for Sunday also, and maybe even get them another win, like you said.
Talking about cars that are making moves, how about the local boy, J.J. Yaley, in the one car, the James Finchon car, started back in 18th position all the way up to 9th. Also the 26 car, give a call to McMurray, Jamie McMurray there, being shown in the top 10. He's in 8th spot as Yaley tries to make the move. Mike.
And Doc, he was as high as 6th just before that final restart, but there was a little bit of alarm in his voice as he radioed into his team, telling them that all of a sudden his water temperature shot up to 240 degrees. The instructions to McMurray were to try to find some clean air, try to cool that engine down a little bit. He's done that, but it cost him a couple of positions. Now he's making his move back toward the front, but the temperatures have come down a little bit.
Not too worried about that 240 degrees, but if it keeps climbing, that's when you worry about it. One thing I've seen, too, early in these races, it seems like the water temperature will spike up a little bit, and then it actually comes down after you run a few laps. I've seen that happen before, and maybe that's what's happening here with Jamie.
And I wish I had a good answer for that, Andy. I really don't. But it was a good decision by the crew chief to tell him, say, look, only thing you can do now is pull that car down into clean air so you got that fresh air hitting the front of the grill. Now, that'll definitely cool it down. But he can't pass cars that way. He needs to get up there and get close to them, get them loose, and drive underneath them.
He's got somebody driving underneath him right here, J.J. Yaley, hometown boy now. He's got that home field advantage when he comes to Phoenix.
Well, yeah. He really does. He's running good. You know, we talked about aerodynamics a little while ago. I mean, it's very important here. You get down the back straightaway over 160 miles an hour and put a rear bumper onto somebody getting at the corner, man, you can flat make that guy loose.
Back up front, Casey Kane putting some pressure on Kyle Busch here. Kyle Busch, your leader. Casey Kane has not led in NASCAR Busch competition since the race back in October at Lowe's Motor Speedway. He has never won a Busch race at Phoenix International Raceway. 43 of 200 laps are in the books, and we have a caution flag waving once again here. Trouble up in turn four, and that is the youngster, Landon Castle.
Seems to be a theme going here. All these inexperienced guys are bringing out the caution flag.
Yeah, it's too bad. Landon Castle's done a really good job in his car, guys. I mean, he's really into it. I talked to him before the race. He was excited about his opportunity today, and he knows that Rick Hendricks gave him a great car. Didn't even get to the first scheduled stop to make an adjustment to fix the problem he had. But it's getting seat time, guys. That's what's important.
Show you again what happened to the young driver here in turn four, top of your screen.
Looks like he just got loose there, spun around. Hard to see if he anybody touched him or if he had any contact.
Marcus Ambrose on board camera.
Austin Landon. Stay low.
Already up across the racetrack. Landon Castle, the 18-year-old driver for Protege in the Hendrick Motorsports. There's a 25 car. Again, Richard Johns doing a nice job.
Guys, that's a tough corner
yellow's
to get
out,
into.
Yellow's out.
When you sail down into turn three, you can use a little too much brake sometimes. That can get you loose. And you can just flat get in the corner too deep. Just carrying too much speed and get loose. And that corner right there is a sucker one. It sucks you right in there and spins you right out, man.
All right, first pit stop of the day, Andy. What are you going to do?
We're going to get four tires. It's slick old racetrack. We're going to get four tires, make a few adjustments, and go at it again.
Here they come, the five car. Leads him down, and as we go down the pit road for the first pit stop of the day, let's check in with Shannon Spate.
Kyle Busch pulls that car down, number five car, last start in this car in the Busch Series. Says the car's a little tight. They're going to do four tires, track bar adjustment. They're going to take a tear off that window. Mike?
Matt Kenseth's main concern, he's looking for some more overall grip. They're going to make a track bar adjustment, dropping it half around, a four tire change and air pressure. Dave?
Kevin Harvick comes off the track fourth, one air pressure adjustments and a wedge adjustment, a car that will not turn through the center and up off the corner. Jamie?
Casey Kane running new colors of green. He said he needs the front to be a little bit better. They're going to go up a half round of wedge on that left rear. He's having serious radio communication issues with his team right now. They're trying to get that worked out for Casey Kane. Long pit stop for the nine car.
And a curved exit off of pit road. A little bit tricky down there. Wimmer gains four spots. Carl Edwards, the Busch Series champion, up 18 positions. Casey Kane back eight. That's how they came off of pit road. Back with a restart in a moment. Welcome back to Phoenix International Raceway. Caution number four of the day just about to end, and our leader is the driver who did not pit, Greg Biffle, who had pitted on lap 18 after he had spun. He will lead him down. Let's listen in as we go full throttle.
Ready, green.
Green.
Back up.
Still there. There you go. Good job.
The five car. Here's the Scott Wimmer back in, mired in traffic and trying to come back to the front. There it is, Kevin Harvick behind him. There's Biffle, the leader. Behind him is the 33 car of Tony Raines. How about the five car all the way down on the apron of the racetrack?
Man, take a look at it. Looks like the whole field's on the apron. They're all gaggled together right there. They're on the throttle. And man, these restarts are really something else. They get so bound up, so much racing going on, and they're all over the up place right now. Still going on.
This 47 car is Kelly Byers. He stayed out because he pitted on one of these earlier cautions, and he's got these guys kind of seized up, and that's why you see so much racing double file behind him.
So you call that the haves and have-nots.
That's exactly right.
Some
he has no tires.
He has no tires. You're right.
As you watch this five car, Dale Jarrett, have you seen a guy this aggressive this early on in a race in Phoenix in a long time?
No, probably not until he was here the last time. And, you know, Kyle's just very aggressive. That's just his style, and you know that. He likes the way that his car is driving, obviously, and he goes out there to have fun and pass as many cars as he possibly can. And I think he really enjoys these type of situations to where he gets back in the pack and has to pass these cars, make the moves, and he's doing things on the racetrack that others aren't. He's passing on the apron, and he's passing on the outside.
Yeah, one thing for sure, he better be happy. He's got some veterans around him right now because he's obviously not as fast as the guy with the new tires. And you just saw Kevin Harvick right there. He actually gave him a break.
Yeah, and you got to have some of that give and take here. And I think that's what you see from these veterans. And Andy brought up a good point just a minute ago about the young guys having some difficulty. And I think there's another side with that, too, is they know that these other guys are running these coilbine setups. They're running big springs in the rear. That makes these cars difficult to drive, but you need that to be able to go fast and try to learn. But you put that combination with a very slick racetrack, and it puts these young guys in a very difficult position, and we see them having a hard time today. And this is just great racing right here.
Hey, DJ, what is the typical mistake that a young driver would make at a track like Phoenix? We've seen a lot of these guys having trouble here early on.
Yeah, I think the one thing is what Rusty was talking about a while ago is overdriving the corners. You get yourself down in there, and then you're in no man's land. Once you overdrive it, then you try to get the car slowed down and on the brakes, and then you get it out of shape. And we've all been there, and unfortunately, these guys are learning the hard way.
DJ, it also looks like they're really stacking up on the entry getting into turn three. They're carrying so much speed through the tri-oval back there. They get down in that turn three and they're all over the brakes. It looks like that might cause some problems too.
Yeah, and that happens as you get the cars. You know, the guys right in front, it doesn't seem to mind too much, but as you get third, fourth, and fifth back in line, you can't see that happening right in front of you. And all of a sudden, you have to jump on the brakes really hard. The guy behind you doesn't see that happening, and he's into the back of you, and that creates a big problem.
Well, it's great to be able to have two former NASCAR Nextel Cup champions talking about what happens on this racetrack with the veterans as well as the young guys. Now, here's a battle. Speaking of veterans, how about Jason Keller back there in the 11 car in front of Byers? There's the 11 of Keller, all-time record for starts in NASCAR Busch Series history. Coming full-time in 2008 here with a great operation. Good to have Jason back full-time. Back up front, Greg Biffle is the leader in the 16 car. There is Biffle.
Greg Biffle changed tires and pitted when he spun out over there on lap 24, I believe it was. And so he's got tires from there, and it looked like they're hanging in there pretty good with these guys with stickers.
Yeah, they really are, and I'm really surprised about that, Andy, but evidently the clean air, that downforce he's getting to the front of that car is everything in the world. You get back in traffic, as Dale, you know, man, that could be a tough thing, get stuck in that traffic.
There's a 20 car coming, Denny Hamlin. Right in front of the 27, and that is Robbie Gordon, by the way. And speaking of Robbie Gordon at 27, let's check in his pits with Mike.
And you got to give him a lot of credit, Doc. You know, Robbie Gordon's the eighth driver to wheel that 27 car this year, and Newt Moore really trying to really get some consistency. Well, the race didn't start off too good. They slammed the wall. They had to stop and pit that car twice under caution, pulling out the right side fender, trying to make sure it's, you know, in good shape. He says the car is very solid, and it looks that way right now, running in the top three after scraping the wall early. You got to give that team a lot of credit.
You know, you take a look at this 27 right now with Robbie Gordon driving the car. There's, like Mike said, there's been many drivers, and that's the reason it's so important to have the owner's points. You can put all the drivers you want. As long as that thing's up in the points, he's in the race if something goes wrong.
But Clarence Brewer, the longtime owner there, selling the operation or selling the majority ownership of the operation. And that 27 car, and they got some pretty aggressive plans for 2008. Biffle is the leader, second position. Here comes Kenseth to the high side, and has fresh tires. He will just sail right by Tony Raines in the 33 car. As does a 20 car, I should say. Denny Hamlin takes second spot. Raines is third, and Kenseth back in fourth. 59 of 200 laps complete. Could Greg Biffle finally get his first win in 2007? Looking awfully good here early on.
You
beautiful sight looking down on the Phoenix International Raceway, where the NASCAR Busch Series race today just passed a quarter distance. 65 of the 200 laps are complete, and our aerial coverage is brought to you by Goodyear, the official tire of NASCAR, helping NASCAR drivers get to the finish line for over 50 years. Greg Biffle out in front by not pitting under the last caution. Had stopped a little bit earlier, but the red car, Denny Hamlin's catching him quickly.
Yeah, one of those guys we talked about earlier in the show that has a great track record here, and he's run Greg Biffle down. Now, have a great race for first here as Matt Kenseth is in this mix, too.
Yeah, Denny Hamlin's so aggressive at all these racetracks. In the past several weeks, he's always been coming towards the front. He had a great run going here last time. Look for him to be a serious threat throughout the rest of the day.
New leader, Doc.
Denny Hamlin sails by, and Biffle guys are sitting duck, not having pitted since lap 18, so those tires really going away on him, and these fresh tires taking their toll.
Boy, Doc, this isn't much of a surprise. Denny Hamlin up there leading the race right now. He's such a good driver on the short tracks. That's where he cut his teeth. He won a lot of races at Hickory Motor Speedway, Andy tracks like that. This guy has been so good on these style, and it's got to be the reason why.
Yeah, this track is very similar to the Bull Rings, even though it's a lot bigger. The track surface is a lot the same, and slip and slide and all that. But Matt Kenseth, he's got about the best-looking car right now. I know that Denny got there first, but I think this 17 car's got something for him.
Matt Kenseth, who won this race a year ago from the pole, he led 125 laps. He's been awfully good here at Phoenix. And now looking for an opening inside the 20 car.
You see that 20 car slipping the rear tires off the corner, allows Matt Kenseth to catch up, and I think that's going to be the difference here. I think Matt's car's just got a little better handling off the corner than the 20 does.
Biffle hanging tough there. Remember, he hasn't pitted since lap 18, so those tires are hanging on. It might be something to think about toward the end of this race is how well you can hang on here with two tires or no tire.
Yeah, we were just kind of speculating that the guys that didn't change tires would be sitting ducks. And they, you know, Greg Biffle did lose the lead, but he sure did hang in there a lot longer than we expected. So that could be a factor later in the race. These guys are probably paying attention to that.
You know, we were watching Matt Kenseth just a little while ago. The way he went into turn three, he went in. It looks like he ran up about a lane high, backed out a little bit early, diamond with the corner, we call it, and really pick the gas up and run right up on the bumper of Denny Hamlin. There's many ways to manipulate the throttle and the groove to get off the corner. Now, here's a low approach he's doing to Denny Hamlin. Coming down the back straightaway now, a lot of momentum, about 160 miles per hour coming back through here. Let's see what he does here. Runs up the top of the track and tries to dive underneath him again. Diamond in the corner. And folks, take a look at this. He's going to run up underneath him now.
Yeah, and look who's coming back here. That five car just inhaling the racetrack here. Watch, here comes Mr. Aggression, Kyle Busch, and he is faster than either one of those cars he's chasing right now.
Man, when you get two cars racing side by side, it really slows both of you down and lets that third guy run you down.
You're leading the race here, Rusty, in the 20 car, and it's not even halfway. How hard are you going to race this guy for the spot? I mean, you're going to try to keep it? Are you going to race hard and risk anything here?
Well, I'm going to try, you know, wear him down just a little bit. I'm not going to do anything to sacrifice my own car, Andy, but you know, if you give up the spot, you got to remember you're going to be behind him. It's going to cost your car not to handle as well.
So it's that clean air is worth fighting for.
That clean air is worth fighting for, as long as you're fighting with it with a veteran. Somebody knows how to do it with you.
Speaking of fighting, you heard Shannon Spake say earlier that this is the last time that Kyle Busch will be in that five car, the Hendrick car. So he wants to go out with a win for Alan Gustafson and all these guys that have worked so hard this year on both the Busch car and the Cup car. He'd like to be able to give him a win, but so would the 20 guys up there in Denny Hamlin's pits. Jamie.
Well, Doc, talk about how beneficial a pit stop can be. Denny Hamlin started 14th. He came in, he said, my car is tight in the center, and we have a battle for the lead right now. He came in and said his car is tight in the center. Dave Rogers, crew chief, made a quick track bar adjustment, and Denny Hamlin has been sailing, and now he just got passed by Matt Kenseth.
Watching battle left of your screen, Kenseth becomes the newest leader. He becomes the seventh different driver to lead today. There have been seven lead changes, seven drivers. And on the right side of your screen, the 29 car of Wimmer having his own little battle there with Robbie Gordon in the 27. And the 60, our Busch driver's champion, Carl Edwards. More on Wimmer with Dave.
And, Doc, I want to talk about how this owner's championship for the 29 is important, not just to the owner. Rusty mentioned it at the start of the broadcast, how it guarantees starting spots for the following year. But, you know, if you think about it, this 29 car has been driven by Scott Wimmer today and Jeff Burton alternately throughout the year. And together, they've done better than Carl Edwards in his car and the 20 car of Denny Hamlin with like five or six drivers. So it's really for the team. Yeah, the owner has the name, but the guys who work for the owner, they're proud to say at the end of the year, we beat those other cars. We were all in all the races, and we beat them.
Boy, Dave, you're exactly right. I mean, the team guys have really got a big step in their saddle when they know their car ran good, no matter what driver's in it. And they worked their guts out to try to get this car up there. Now, take a look at the 60 Carl Edwards now. Here's a guy that's already locked up the driver's championship. And Andy, all he wants to do is win now.
Yeah, they rolled the dice on the last pit stop and only took two tires. And you see him passing this 27 car, which stayed out. What you're seeing is the cream rising to the top. And by that, I mean the tires. The best tires are actually making their way to the front. Not as fast as we thought, but they are coming to the front.
Yeah, this is the 6th, 7th, and 8th place cars. Wimmer, Robbie Gordon, and Carl Edwards. And, of course, right behind them, Kevin Harvick in 9th spot as you ride along with Kevin. There's a look back at Gordon, Edwards, Harvick. By the way, McMurray is right there. These guys who have made four tire stops trying to make their way to the front. And right behind him comes a 9-car Casey Kane. Now side by side, Edwards trying to get on the inside of Robbie Gordon for position.
You know, Kevin Harvick, he's got a good car. He's being held up by these two, getting a little bit impatient. You saw him making it three wide, and that's not what you want to do unless you know you can get it done doing that. But it's got to happen fast. You can't race three wide around this place.
Track position so important. You see this 21 car, he's over 7 seconds behind the leader, kind of caught behind these guys. The first guys that had good tires got out there and got the lead, and they got out front. But these other guys, even though they have new tires, it's still real hard to get this track position back.
Well, the owner who could win the championship in terms of car owners is Richard Childress right there. His cars have won the most events this year in Busch competition, a 12-time winner with those three cars, now trying to become an owner's champion here again today. Back in Phoenix International Raceway, along with Andy Pichter, Rusty Wallace, I'm Jerry Punch. Glad to have you with us here for a live NASCAR Busch Series action. And we now have had the 8th lead change of the afternoon. Here's what happened a moment ago with the 5 car of Kyle Busch.
Oh, he's power sliding off the corner. Didn't get it done right there, but goes down here in turn one and just closes the deal. Looks like Matt probably gave it to him.
Yeah, I started to say that was an amazing pass right there. He actually got loose off the corner, power sliding, as you said, Andy. And generally that loses some momentum, but it looks like he gained momentum and made the pass. But, you know, I think Matt's a pretty smart driver. Said, hey, enough of this. Let him go.
Here at the Arizona Travel 200, we are 114 laps to go. 86 are complete. We've had 8 lead changes among 7 different drivers. Clint Bowyer, who was a pole sitter, has led the most today thus far. He's led twice for 28 laps. 20 car, Denny Hamlin had led for 7 laps, and he was trying to hang on in the owner's points, but could there be issues developing? Let's listen in.
Motor's blown up.
How does the gauges look when you get a chance? Water's out. Make sure you got oil pressure.
Push boxes. Already did it.
Have you looked at your voltmeter?
It's fine. Do we have another battery?
No, we do not have another battery. As long as the voltmeter's fine, we're okay on that end.
Now, you heard crew chief Dave Rogers say, no, we don't have another battery. What he's saying is they don't have a spare on the car. They only have their primary battery. So the crew got word of that. They brought out the backup battery right here. They got the screwdriver out. So they're going to watch and monitor those gauges. If it gets bad enough, Denny Hamlin's going to have to come down pit road. They're going to have to replace the battery. You see the crew right now huddling together, guys, maybe having to go to work on this 20 car. Unfortunate, because they thought they had a car capable of winning here today.
Jamie, with more on that, let's go down to our Chevy cutaway car and Tim Brewer.
Jamie, you're exactly right. They don't have the luxury of having a 2-battery switch in the car. So what they have to do is come in, remove the left rear tire, move the foam padding, disconnect the battery, literally pull it out and replace it. And they probably will not lose a lap under caution, but you got to be really quick. You got to have the cam locks on the battery box, get the door off, get it back on, replace the battery. They'll be lucky if they don't lose a lap here. Jerry?
Thank you, Tim. It can be done quickly, but it's going to cost you a lot of valuable time. For more information on batteries, log on to ESPN.com, search word Auto Tech.
Well,
that's okay if it is the battery, but what I heard in all that conversation is that the bolts were good and they changed boxes. They tried to find all these things that may be electrical that they could fix, but what he has may be an internal engine problem that they may not be able to fix. They're hoping it's something they can change.
You know, take a look at his lap times right now, Andy. He's ran a 29.30 that last lap compared to 29.05 for the leader, so he's about 2.5 tenths of a second off. But not a lot. I mean, it's not running. He's not far enough off the pace to make me think that he's on seven cylinders.
But something's wrong because he was leading the race, and here he is now in eighth spot and still losing some ground. So there's something wrong up there. He doesn't know exactly what it is, but there's definitely something wrong.
Denny Hamlin, a five-time winner in Busch competition. Three of those wins coming this year, the latest one in Dover, Delaware, back in the fall. Nine laps away from halfway here at Phoenix International Raceway. They call this track the Jewel of the Desert. It is a one-mile oval with a dogleg in the backstretch. Almost five turns they have to negotiate right now. Kyle Busch doing the best job of all. We welcome you back to the Arizona Travel 200. It is stop number 34 of 35 on the $50 million NASCAR Busch Series Tour for 2007. Winding down here a little bit. Final drive for Kyle Busch in that five car for Hendrick Motorsports. Remember, he heads to Joe Gibbs Racing in 2008. Well, he'll be driving a Toyota. See what he can do. He's sliding a little bit sideways, and take a look. It's been a tale of two seasons for him as well. Last eight starts, three wins, and eight top five finishes. And he has led the most laps seven times. As we go down, we'll go up to speed here, starting with our leader, Kyle Busch, and Shannon Spake.
Well, that's right. Kyle Busch is your leader, currently making his way through some of that lap traffic. Now, we obviously mentioned how this is his last start here at Hendrick Motorsports. Wants to go to victory lane because of that reason. But there's another reason, too. He won the truck race here last night, which means he's won here at Phoenix in the Cup and the truck and would like to do it in the Busch Series as well. His best finish here at Phoenix is second in 2004. Right now, telling his crew chief that the car is good. Mike?
Matt Kenseth's crew chief, Drew Blickensderfer, told me this morning, anytime he comes to a track like this with these characteristics, a flat one-mile racetrack, the way he measures how good his car is against the Richard Childress Racing cars. But he told me that this weekend, for the first time this year at a track like this, they measure up pretty well. They feel like they've got a very fast race car. Right now, a little bit loose off, tight middle, but still looking for a little grip. Jamie?
Well, what happened to our pole sitter? Mr. Cliff Boyer worked his way back up to third spot after that last pit stop. He got pitched off, exiting. He lost about seven spots. Well, if you look at the lap times, he's turning times faster than your leader, Kyle Busch, right now. He's worked his way up to third, and he actually brushed the wall just a few moments ago, but they came on the radio and said, you're fine, car looks good. Let's go to Dave Burns.
Well, Greg Biffle has a pretty good race car, Jamie, but he pitted last on lap 18, which Doc pointed out earlier, so he's going to have to pit the next five or six laps, probably, depending on how much the caution laps have helped him, to try to get this thing back full of fuel, so he'll be out of sequence, but a pretty good race car right now, just a little bit loose. Loose was the problem for Scott Wimmer. They seem to have corrected that on this run. He restarted 50, stayed in that position. No complaints from Scott. No major changes planned for the next stop as well. Mike?
Well, Dave, aside from being able to spray champagne, take home a nice shiny trophy and a big check, there's another benefit to winning this Busch Series championship for Carl Edwards. And, of course, that's the freedom to gamble. Pierre Coutel was able to do that last time down pit road. Took only two tires. It gave them the track position they were looking for. But right now, the tires they have are losing grip. He came over the radio not too long ago saying, I really could use some fresh rubber. Jamie?
And I'll take it from here, Mike, on the 21 car of Kevin Harvick, who was complaining about the motor down the straightaway, just not enough pull down the straightaway, according to the driver. And he's driving as hard as he can, also a quote from him. That's because his car is tight in the center of the corner, so kind of fighting the steering wheel and wishing he had more horsepower. Now, when spotter Joey Meyer told Brian Vickers that the 10 cars in front of you are all slower than you, I thought that was a little bit optimistic, even to encourage your driver. But you know what? Brian Vickers has passed all those cars that Joey Meyer was talking about. He's all the way up inside the top 10 now. He restarted 20th, Jamie.
And Casey Kane, that last pit stop was super long for him, 17.5 seconds. Why? Because the right side jack wasn't up high enough. They had issues getting the tires on and off, but he's working his way back up. He has both of his crew chiefs, Cup and Busch, sitting on the pit box. That tells me he's got a fast car. Casey Kane working his way up in ninth right now. Behind him, David Rudiman. He failed to qualify for the Cup race, guys, but he continues to charge here in the Busch Series. He's got a car that he feels is capable of winning here. David Rudiman pretty quick here in the spring, and he says his car so far, so so good running in the top 10 right now. Doc?
Thank you, Jamie. The last time David Ruderman failed to qualify for a cup race was Atlanta. Guess what he did? He went up to Memphis and won the Busch race, his first ever Busch win in his 63rd career start. And the 20 car still fading. Remember, we showed you the battery issues. Possibly, is it battery? Is it internal in the engine? He's just trying to hang on now. That is 15th position that Denny Hamlin has drifted back to.
And, Doc, he's really lost a lot of time right now. He's running 29.90s, and that's over 7-tenths of a second slower than the leader. So definitely something's amiss with that car of his. Guys, I got to tell you, I'm a little surprised we haven't had some cautions here. We've had so many when the race started. And now it looks like these guys have settled in.
Here's Jason Leffler, by the way, the 38 car. Leffler, remember, he is locked in that third in the points battle, just 20 points ahead of Kevin Harvick with two races to go. Among the Busch-only drivers, Leffler right there at the top of the rank. He'd be the number one overall driver in terms of Busch-only points. Leffler in the 38 car now going by the 20 to take the 15th position away. Speaking of Busch-only drivers, Bobby Hamilton Jr. being shown six in the points. As he has just been past the 35 car, Bobby Hamilton Jr., the Ed Renzi-owned car. Well, Kyle Busch is the leader. Busch now has led the most laps of the afternoon. He's led twice for 38 laps. Kenseth, Bowyer, Biffle, and Wimmer, the top five, as we are now past the halfway point.
This telecast of the NASCAR Busch Series is available in high definition on ESPN 2 HD, presented by Vizio. Just across the halfway mark of the Arizona Travel 200 NASCAR Busch Series today at Phoenix International Raceway. After a halting start, four cautions in 43 laps. Now we have gone some 60 laps without a yellow flag. And Kyle Busch is parading around out front.
Kyle Busch has checked out on these guys. It's amazing how these Cup guys come to the front at the middle of the end of the, or towards the end of these races. The cream kind of rises to the top. I was watching young Stephen Light and Brad Coleman. They were running really well earlier, but they're starting to fade back a little bit, Dale, and these good Cup guys are starting to eat up some space.
Yeah, they are, and what's happening basically is this racetrack's getting slicker, and these guys are Cup regulars for a reason, and they're used to handling these type of situations and cars on tires like this for a longer period of time. And it's just very impressive to sit here and watch these guys like Kyle Busch and Matt Kenseth, as we've watched coming out of turn four in particular, as you'll see Michael McDowell going down pit road here, but watch them come out of turn four hustling these cars, sliding these cars. Their hands working. I mean, they're getting a workout out there, but they're not backing out of the throttle. You see them run lap after lap like this, and to me, that's just very impressive to watch them do this.
And the caution flag is out. What's up, Doc?
Caution on the racetrack. Big break for Stephen Wallace, who was just about to go a lap down. Wallace had driven the back of the pack all the way up into the mid-20s there. He's 26th position as the yellow flies for the fifth time. There's a look at Stephen and the Home Life Communities Dodge, and had trouble in qualifying. Started the back of the pack and driven up in the middle, but he was being run down by the five car of Kyle Busch, and that will not happen now.
Bobby Hamilton Jr. will thank him for that, because he'll get the lucky dog now instead of the 66. If the five car had passed 66, he would have got it.
Nice of the Bobby Hamilton to be able to Jr. to get the lucky dog. There's the five car of Kyle Busch, and also a big break for Greg Biffle, by the way. You heard Dale Jarrett and Brad Daugherty talking about how well these tires develop. Guys, Biffle has been out there almost 100 laps on these Goodyears. How good are the Goodyears here?
Yeah, the tires have been pretty good. This is the same tire they ran at New Hampshire, Richmond, Virginia. Places like that, Indianapolis Raceway Park, these guys really like these tires. Pretty durable, guys.
By the way, the caution is for debris on the racetrack. Some little shiny metal coming off a couple of cars. Went off the yellow flag, and then brings these guys on the pit road as they head down to Shannon's Bay.
Kyle Busch radioed in and said, guys, please give me a good pit stop. I'm leading this race. Car is perfect. Four tires and fuel for Kyle Busch, your race leader. Mike.
Matt Kenseth still looking for a little bit more overall grip. The only adjustment they'll make is an air pressure adjustment. Four tires and fuel for the 17 car. Dave?
Biffle was to be on pit road under green this lap. They just caught their break. Air pressure and track bar adjustments for a little loose race car. Jamie?
All the way down pit road in the number one pit box. Cliff Boyer said he starts off real loose and he gets tight too quick. They're going to make an air pressure adjustment for Cliff Boyer. Four tires and fuel. He's down in a
put those lug nuts on the right front tire, and that cost him a few extra seconds. So he got a break by getting a caution flag and then got a bad break on pit road. There's the race off. You see Kenseth loses a spot. Carl Edwards up two. Remember, Edwards had only taken two tires on the previous stop. You see very close between the 5 and the 2. There comes the 17 and Wimmer. Okay, let's watch this pit stop from Kerry Wimmish's vantage point. Here's the jackman for Clint Bowyer on the 2 car.
The jackman's like the quarterback. He's the one that's kind of directing everything. The car doesn't go until he drops it. He's coming around here to the left side. That's the signal the driver will be waiting for. When this jack comes down on the left side, he's free to go. And so this jackman has to make sure that all the tires are tight and it's ready.
Kerry Wimmish says that being a jackman on Saturday helps him on Sunday as well. Now let's watch what happened with Biffle. Watch the right front.
These guys are changing the right sides and they're going to zip around here to the other side. Probably a lug nut is missing. You'll see this official. He happened to catch it out of the corner of his eye. He says, okay, you got to fix this before it goes out or you'll have to come back.
They have to come back around now after changing left side tires. That cost him. They had to find the lug nut. That cost him about 5.5 extra seconds. And certainly, but Biffle did get a break with a yellow flag, being able to pit under yellow. Back in a moment. Back at Phoenix International Raceway, under caution for the fifth time today, debris on the racetrack. Now let's show you what happens on pit road with regard to pit stops, and there's a lot of brake dust on these cars, and these guys that they have to deal with, they get a face full of brake dust. Here is the 99 car of David Rudiman. John Butter Royer, the front tire changer, look at his vantage point.
Wow, look at that wheel that comes off, and look at that pretty shiny chrome wheel going back on. I've changed these front tires for a lot of years, and that brake dust collects in there. Man, it is some kind of a nuisance when you're changing that tire.
Well, you're pretty hard on the brakes here, Andy, especially getting down into turn one. Not so much into turn three, but turn one's much more of a 90-degree entry, so you use more brakes. And boy, it really puts a lot of dust. It's tough on these tire changers that way.
20 car on pit road. You heard the explanation about possible battery problems. They're looking under the hood as well. Jamie.
They've come in three times now for Denny Hamlin. He's gone down two laps now. What they found out is all cylinders are hot. That's a good thing. They thought they lost a cylinder. Right now, they just exchanged all those spark plugs, all 8 of them, because there's no way to diagnose which one is the problem. So it's very meticulous what they're doing, working on pit road right now. He's going to go back out. If that's not the problem, it'll be the carburetor exchange, guys.
Thank you, Jamie. Hamlin had led 7 laps. Now shows it shows 2 laps down in 35th position. Kyle Busch leads him down. 79 laps to go here at Phoenix. Clint Bowyer was the pole sitter. He's in hot pursuit.
He used that number one pit stall to gain a spot on pit road. Now he's going to be able to chase this 5 car down if he's got a good enough car.
Late afternoon sun here in Phoenix, and this track historically begins to change as the sun begins to set here, guys.
Oh, definitely. The track's going to cool off, Jerry. The cars are going to handle different. They're going to do two things, guys. They're going to run faster, and they're probably going to start push the front end. You get in the corner and turn the front end, and whoa! See Clint Bowyer right now getting loose. He might be just hustling that corner too. A little too hard right now with the air pressures down on the tires. But the track is going to change. Generally going to get tighter, start losing the front end.
Speaking of really putting a lot of steering in these cars, you see the 2 car wrestling with the car. We saw a moment ago earlier the 17 car of Matt Kenseth really fighting and wrestling with the steering wheel. Could there be an issue with the 17 car of Matt Kenseth?
Mike and Doc, there definitely is an issue for sure. You know, some people wonder why these drivers spend so much time in their weight rooms, getting stronger, building up endurance. Well, for Matt Kenseth, it's for days like this. Not only is it hot behind the wheel of that race car, but the wheel itself not turning real well.
Losing my power steering here slow, but sure as we go. Fluid leak. Getting worse and worse. It's starting to stick.
Just talked to Drew Blickensderfer and asked him if there was anything they could do. He just shook his head and kind of gave him the arm, showing off the bicep, if you will, just trying to say that this is all in Matt Kenseth's arms right now, but they really can't do anything about the race car. But further explanation as to what it's like to have a car without power steering, let's go to our Dish Tech Center and Tim Brewer.
Thanks, Mike. Hey, we've got two different applications here. This is the power steering pump, belt driven off the front of the engine. You know, it's contained right here as far as the fluid area. We have another remote reservoir that's used back here in the back, and it's bolted against the firewall.
But when you're having an issue, the fluid level's gone way down. There again, might be aerating. It's not turning properly, or just like Matt said, maybe all the fluid run out. But there again, better eat your Wheaties because it's going to be a long day here in Phoenix. Jerry?
Yeah, Tim, it could be a weedy afternoon. Folks, Trevor, turn your car off and then try to turn the steering wheel sitting in the parking lot. You've got to be a behemoth to do that. Now, for more information on steering, log on to ESPN.com. Search word know-how. And, DJ, that is a handful of a race car when you do not have power steering working, or even worse, maybe when it's working only part-time.
Yeah, you know, the biggest thing is you don't exactly know what's going to happen. And you can say, well, the guys years ago, and when I started racing, we didn't have power steering. Rusty, the same way, you didn't have power steering. But the boxes were made to work without that. These boxes are made to work with power steering and with everything working properly. And when they don't, you can't get a good feel for the wheel. You have to turn it a little bit, and then you almost have to jerk it at one point. And I think that's one of the reasons Matt Kenseth is usually one of the smoothest guys that we see with the steering wheel, and we see him working it awful hard every day.
Well, Dale, one thing I'm seeing right now, Andy and I have been up here in the booth, take a look at the 17 car. He's got a lot of smoke coming out of the right side of the car. And, Andy, could that be a leak out of the reservoir, and he's lost his fluid and is causing this problem?
I've seen smoke coming out of the 17 car at least a half a dozen times, and I thought it was tire smoke, but now looking back, it could be a loose line on the power steering and causing that steering to get jerky. And once it gets low, like Tim Brewer said, it starts getting air in it, and then you see it again right there. That could be power steering fluid coming out of that car.
Dale, you were talking earlier about power steering versus non-power steering. The caster settings on these cars, the way it makes it lead into the corner and turn easier, harder, much, much different settings on a non-power steering box versus what these fellows are driving now.
Yeah, absolutely. With the non-power steering boxes, we used to run the camber spread was quite a bit. We'd actually run a negative camber, in the left front, and about 1 degree there, and then a split of about 3.5 on the right front, so the car would really lead into the corner. With the power steering boxes, what we can do to help get the car into the corner and it not be loose, and we can have more control of that steering wheel, is we'll run that closed up quite a bit. You'll run 3 degrees positive caster in the right front, sometimes even 4, and maybe 5 in the right front. So you have a lot more input into that wheel as a driver, and you won't get as loose down in the corner. So when that goes away, you really have your hands full. You, as they were saying, you really have to be strong, and these are the days that you know that working out has really paid off.
Riding along behind Matt Kenseth, that there was some fluid coming out of the car. You would see it on this onboard camera for Scott Wimmer, and this camera is clean. Oh, the 10 car, trouble.
Front damage, a little bit of left rear damage. We got spun by the 41.
Well, there you hear what happened. Brian Vickers got a constant contact from the 41 car.
He's got a lot of damage on the car. Trying to hustle around here.
Now, guys, this will give the opportunity for Matt Kenseth to come down if he chooses and take a look what's going on with this power steering problem. They could tighten the lines back up.
Quite a bit of damage. Heavy left front damage.
Show you what happened again. There's the 41 car and the 10 of Brian Vickers.
This is something that commonly happens here at this racetrack. You get in a corner so deep, then you get up alongside somebody, and you just lose the car and slide up into them.
Well, the one thing I see here, these are teammates in the Cup Series, and I don't know why they're roughing each other up like that.
By the way, it is A.J. Allmendinger in the 41 car driving the Ganassi Sabatas car.
Down. Keep coming. All clear. Got nothing yet. Yellow's out.
This could hurt that relationship just a little bit on the Cup side, but Vickers had a fast car, man. It's too bad to see it get tore up.
All right, pit stops, crew chief. What do you do here?
Well, this is one of those tough ones where it's just, you know, they can easily make it from here. You might see some guys come in here, and if they do, you'll see some different strategies. This is where they'll earn their money.
Remember, Biffle ran 100 laps on those tires and hung in the top four, didn't lose much at all. Does someone stay out and roll the dice and just stay on the racetrack? Here comes the 5. He stays out. Looks like everyone up front going to stay out.
It's going to be an opportunity for some of these guys if they come in here, from some of these guys running behind the leaders. Nobody seems to be wanting to take the bait, though.
26 cars on the lead lap. Here come some cars back in the pack. 77 of Hornaday. By the way, the lucky dog goes to the 59 car, Marcus Ambrose. And he's the first car a lap down. He will get the lucky dog, the Aaron's lucky dog free pass. 77 Hornaday, 90 Stephen Light, the Kentucky winner. These guys come on the pit road to make their stops. And folks, mark this down, because these guys are not going to have to come back in. Others might. Going to be awfully close here on fuel. Lots of action here throughout the afternoon here. 134 laps. We've had six caution flags. Lots of pushing and shoving and contact. NASCAR Busch Series stops. Coverage of NASCAR Nextel Cup Series action, 3 o'clock Eastern time on ABC. It is the 35th of 36 races, and it's coming down to two drivers in the championship, 30 points apart. Teammates, two drivers, two teammates, one championship. Could they take another step toward a title? We'll find out at 3 o'clock Eastern time on ABC.
And what is it you call that next to the last race stop?
The penultimate event.
Yeah, that was it.
That's a big word, man. I don't know if I can pronounce that one.
All right, we're going to get set for the restart here. Pace car is going to pull away. Kyle Busch is the leader. Clint Bowyer in second spot. Kenseth is third. Remember the power steering issues there. Wimmer fourth. Could they bring home an owner's championship today? Green flag. Just 63 laps to go. Trouble. Biffle involved, McMurray involved. And Stephen Wallace up across the racetrack.
He has a better view than I do.
Golly, boy, that was just unbelievable. This has happened many times here at this racetrack. A driver spins the tires on a restart, gets hit in the back, and a lot of them are collected right now. Unbelievable.
We talked about this just before we went on. We were talking about how this racetrack, the front straightaway is so slick, and these restarts, we see guys pile up on the restarts here on this track a lot.
And guys, right now the sun is setting in turn one. It's just almost blinding up in our booth here at Phoenix. I'm looking out the window right now. It's almost impossible to see into turn one at the moment.
So if somebody has a problem on these restarts, it's really hard to see ahead of you with that sun glaring in your face.
Yeah, right now, Andy, you're just driving off the guy's bumper in front of you. And obviously, they couldn't see ahead what was coming down and what was getting ready to happen here.
Jason Keller's 11 car involved. Let's show you again the restart now. Watch them as they stack up here at the top of your screen there.
And you can see J.J. Yelly got in the back of Jamie McMurray and spun him. J.J. just did nothing to do there. I mean, Jamie couldn't do anything about it. He's blocking the track right now. Everybody's stacking up. Another melee in the front straightaway at Phoenix, kind of like we had at Atlanta, Georgia.
Different angle. Watch them stack up now. It'll be on the bottom of your screen this time. Contact, you'll see the pop from behind there. The 26 car McMurray gets hit by Yaley, and it all breaks loose behind him.
I have to believe that sun has something to do with that, because these guys couldn't see that this thing was stacking up in front of them.
No, this is a big problem, the sun going into turn one. We thought for a while that maybe the sweets were going to block the sun, but it's not. And it looks like JJ tried to get underneath the 26 of McMurray and just caught him, and look at this. Now it's all smoke. Nobody can see anything.
Now take a look at David Reagan's onboard camera. How much can't you see?
All clear. Right width outside. Got a break in here. Check up. Come middle. Up. Come on. Watch him.
Guys, that's how bad the sun is. It's just horrible out there.
Young second generation driver Stephen Wallace climbing out of his car after having driven from all the way from the back of the pack. To drive this car up into the middle of the field and on his way to the front, and he will climb out. There is Greg Biffle. He was still trying to chase that elusive first victory. He's won a race every year, six consecutive years in the NASCAR Busch Series. Thought he had one in the late laps at Texas last week and had a tire go down. And now we are under a red flag here at Phoenix while we clear the racetrack. It is the seventh caution flag of the day. Coming up on lap 137, it is the first red flag of the day. We'll clean up the debris and come back and talk to a few drivers in just a moment. Well, the Gators of Florida need a win to stay alive in the tough SEC East race. Tonight, they face a tough test when they visit their former coach, Steve Spurrier, and those feisty South Carolina Gamecocks. Williams-Brice Stadium, Columbia, South Carolina. College football primetime, presented by Hampton Hotels on ESPN tonight at 7:45 Eastern time. College football lives here. We're on under a red flag here at Phoenix International Raceway because of this wreck on the restart involving four cars. Contact Yaley at the top of your screen. McMurray's car gets spun around. Behind him, there's contact in the back of the 16 of Biffle. Heavy damage there, also involving Stephen Wallace and Jason Kell. Let's go down to Jamie.
Well, Greg Biffle's okay right now. He's watching our monitor. What happened? You don't even know who was in front of you.
No, I don't. You know, it was bad. Somebody looked like they got in the back of the 26 car, and I don't know if Jamie missed a shift or what happened, but it looked like somebody's being a little aggressive and tried to chop the line. That's probably what it was. You can't pull out to the left to cross the start-finish line, and they caught McMurray's left rear quarter panel pulling down, and that's kind of unfortunate. You know, 70 laps to go and a restart to try and pass one car and cause a wreck like that, but it's unfortunate. You know, our car was really good and we had a bad pit stop. We got in the back and figured once we got equal tires we'd be able to run with the leaders, and you know, just never got that chance.
Three different issues today. How are you staying optimistic and keeping in this thing, Greg?
Well, I just love driving this 3M Ford Fusion Busch car, and Eddie and all the guys give me a great car. It's frustrating when we come in fourth and go out 17th on a pit stop, one pit stop. So that really hurt us, you know, and that's what got us in that mess. We'd have been in front of all those guys and been up there battling with Kyle and Matt and those guys for the lead. But things happen for a reason, so we'll try tomorrow.
Track position is everything here at Phoenix. Two-time winner here, Greg Biffle, is out.
Boy, those lug nuts on that right front cost him a lot there. He would have been a factor, been in the top five. Let's visit with our in-race reporter, Kevin Harvick, who's sitting right now back in the fifth position.
Kevin Harvick, Rusty Wallace, ESPN. You got us, buddy?
Yeah, man.
Well, I tell you, Kevin, looks like the sun going into turn one's really bad. They had lost about four or five cars in the front straightaway after a restart there. Was it bothering you?
Not right now. You know, I think you know how the sun can be here in Phoenix, getting down the front straightaway when something happens. The sun's not bad. The biggest problem I got is my glove is not fitting me right today, and I can't close my hand all the way, so it's not working right for me. So that's my biggest problem, not the sun.
Kevin, looks like your team made a good adjustment for you that last time. Really got the car running better yet. You feel like you got it where you want it right now?
Kevin, yeah, he's unable to close that glove. He's not getting the button all the way down. So we're trying to talk to Kevin Harvick there. And well, that's got to be tough when you've only got one hand you can grip the steering wheel with. I've got a feel for Kevin Harvick on a tough track like this when you can't get your hands all the way together around that wheel. Back with a restart here at Phoenix in a moment. Back at Phoenix International Raceway, after a brief red flag and the seventh caution flag today, we're getting set to go back to green flag racing. 60 laps to go. Kyle Busch trying to pick up a win in his final run for Hendrick Motorsports in this Busch car. Kyle Busch has never won at Phoenix. Remember, the owner's championship up for grabs, a 29 car of Scott Wimmer, came in with a 113-point lead. He and Jeff Burton share that car this year. Burton has won four times in this car, the 29 car. And if they were to gain 83 points and leave here 196 points ahead, they would wrap up the NASCAR Busch Series owner title for one Richard Childress.
Boy, another good restart for Kyle Busch, guys. He just sailed that thing down into turn one. It stuck real good. And he's got to get out of Dodge as quick as he possibly can to get away from Clint Boyer, because Boyer's got a fast car.
Two cars been really loose all day, and this track cooling down may have helped his car a little bit. Might come to him here.
And we talked about when the temperature comes out of the racetrack with the sun going down, it generally makes the cars tighter, lose the front end. So basically, that's the same thing as tightening up the back of the car, giving you more grip in the back. So that's a good thing, Andy, for his condition he's got right now.
And Matt Kenseth has had a great car, but he's got that power steering issue, and that's going to make it tough to get up there and really fight these guys for that lead.
Pretty good battle here. The 38 car and 22 Bliss, the runner-up in Memphis, trying to hold off Jason Leffler. These guys are battling for ninth position. Leffler gets by.
Boy, Leffler just gets right across the front bumper of 22. Mike Blitz just barely misses it. Guys, that was a close one on the exit of turn two. Well, this is one of Mike Blitz's favorite racetracks. He always runs good here. anything he drives. Open wheel cars, NASCAR Nextel Cup cars, trucks. He's done it all, been successful at all of it.
Wow, look at this 38 car getting aggressive on the apron.
You know, if you get that left front tire, Andy, down on the apron, you get yourself a lot of grip there. As long as it doesn't upset the car, to make the car too loose, you get up underneath it. And that's happened to a lot of people.
More on Mike Bliss. We'll get on to Mike.
Well, Doc, Mike Bliss, optimistic heading into this race. He learned a lot, he said, in the truck race last night where he finished third. He said he had one concern, however. This is the car they ran at Richmond. He wrecked it in the first practice there, went on to finish fifth. Is also the same car he ran at Memphis. He wrecked it again in practice there and finished second. His big concern coming into this, Doc, he didn't wreck the car at all in practice. He said he felt like he should kick the car or something before he got in it to just give it some good karma.
Yeah, Mike, if you wreck it, how much better can that car get?
He's got some damage on the right side, so he has hit something, Mike. But this car is good. I think this car was brand new at Richmond when they built it there, and that's why they wanted to fix it and run it there, because they had built such a good car. But look at this mess he's got to drive through.
Yeah, that's Rudiman, the 99. Whoa! One of the cars rubbing the wall. Might have been the 42 car of Franchitti.
You see some concrete dust in the wheel, the right rear wheel of the 42, so it was him that hit the wall. But now these guys are stacking up behind him.
Yeah, it's Carl Edwards, the 60 car behind Franchitti. Franchitti, by the way, is a lap down in 25th position. He's the first car not on the lead lap. And right in front of Edwards. Edwards tries to dive down in front of Bliss, and he can't get there.
That's why he's racing so hard here. He wants to try to be the guy that gets that lucky dog. You can't let these guys go and then maintain that spot.
Hey, guys, Dario Franchitti's getting a lot of experience. I mean, he's got to stay up here and hang tough. But now, three wide, that is not what you want right there.
He's trying to stay in front of the 14 car, and he gets turned from behind by Krusolov. Certainly by Keselowski.
Oh, my gosh, that was an unbelievable job of spinning.
That's
and
beautiful.
Going straight.
Need tires to get a heck of a job of saving it.
I mean, he's done this before in IndyCar racing. He just did it just now. And he had those wheels perfectly straight when that car came back around.
Wow.
And it takes a lot of talent to pull that off.
Well, Joey Chitwood would be impressed with that one. 360 at full speed. Now, let's show you, take it back a couple laps, and show you the 42 car, Franchitti, driving to stay in front of Krusolov to get that lucky dog. Coming off the corner, boom.
And, Doc, he just gets too high on the racetrack, out of the groove, no grip up there, Andy, and just slides and into the wall.
That's a pretty hard lick, so I'm sure that's bent some suspension pieces. But he kept in the throttle. You see, he definitely got some help on this one.
See, Brad Keselowski had to back up.
These guys are a little frustrated, though, because this is a lap car, and these guys are trying to race for the win. It's only 52 laps to go. They need to go, you know. They don't want a lap car in the way.
Watch the back of this car come up off the ground. Wow. Well, caution for the 8th time a day, the 42 car. Dario Franchitti trying to stay on the lead lap or trying to get back on the lead lap is a victim here, getting tapped from behind. Spins around, does a complete 360, but brings out the yellow flag. Back in Phoenix, inside of 50 laps to go, Kyle Busch pulling away, now taking the green flag, and it is Bowyer second, Kenseth third, Wimmer fourth. That 20 car, Denny Hamlin, by the way, is four laps down in 31st position. Most recent caution flag was for contact between the 42 car and the 88. Franchitti doing a nice job. Dario Franchitti spinning the car around and getting it back in the right direction.
Well, just Kyle Busch is just so impressive right now, guys. He has just got such a good handle on the car late in the race. But look at this traffic. Two and sometimes three wide going at turn one. And something's got to give. You just can't do it like that. Take a look. Oh, a lap car, Kyle Krusolov. And they're all stacking up again, coming down the back straightaway.
And near incident there. Let's show you. Let's listen into what happened. Let's listen into the radio communications with Brad Keselowski a moment ago after the contact with the 42 or possible contact. Listen in.
He may not be sure, but we're pretty sure. We saw a good replay there. I'm sure he hit that car there and spun him out. So.
Yeah, it looks like he didn't mean to do it, but he got into him pretty good, yeah. You know, and he got him right around the circle. But, boy, what a professional job of driving Dario Franchitti did. I think Great job.
That was not a flyby. That was a touch and go by the 88 car. Shannon?
Yeah, Brett Keselowski's second contact. He actually had contact with the 66 just a couple laps before that. You know, I caught up with Tony Urie Sr. earlier this morning, crew chief for Brad Keselowski, asked him what he thought about Brad's performance, how he's improving. I mean, this kid's had great finishes the past couple weeks. And Tony Sr. said, we just need to teach him how to be calm. He's really eager to win, but we just need him to relax a little bit, and then he'll get there at the end.
Back up front, Matt Kenseth, we talked about the fact that he having just muscled his car and had a handful of steering wheel in terms of power steering that was coming and going. And what a job he's doing now to run down the five car. But it's Kenseth's time of the race, guys. Laps are winding down, and it's time for Matt to start making a difference.
I just wonder if he's got any arm left to steer this car. If he doesn't have any power steering, it's going to be really tough for him to really chase this car and fight this five car for this win. But he's got a great handling race car.
Mike?
Well, they were talking about it over the radio, guys, you know, last caution period, trying to diagnose exactly what was wrong with it. And they think it's something internal. They really have no choice but to just ride this thing out right now. But, you know, certainly you got to give a tip of the cap to Matt Kenseth. It looks like he's in awfully good shape behind that wheel.
Well, I mean, to drive one of these cars with no power steering, I mean, they actually, just like Doc was saying earlier, imagine, folks, turning your key off. You know, and trying to turn your wheel. It's just, you can't hardly turn a wheel on the ground without power steering going. And that's kind of what it is. That's what he feels in this car right now. Very, very hard to turn.
Well, what effect will this fatigue have on him when he's got to run 312 laps here in the Cup car tomorrow?
Well, he's going to be able to rest tonight. Everything will be just fine. And a lot of times, these guys will actually take their elbows and jam them in their sides, Jerry, brace themselves, and turn the car. They just won't use their upper shoulder body strength to turn it when this problem happens. They can brace down in there, and evidently Matt's figured out what he needs to do to adjust to the situation he's got right now.
You know, Dale Jarrett, in the old days, a lot of the guys would adjust where they are in relation to the steering wheel in case they had to use their shoulders to be able to steer the car. How did you do it?
Well, I think you just get yourself in the seat and you got to grab the steering wheel a little bit different. And I have to believe, and I'm not trying to take away from what Matt said, you got to believe with he's as good as he's running here that the power steering is not totally gone on this race car. I think if it goes halfway, because you're used to having all of that power steering there, then it feels like you don't have any at all. But as well as he's running here, I'd have to say that he has some of that. But you just get your arms, like Rusty was saying, you get yourself positioned right there and your arms in a different position to where you can really turn the wheel, and he's actually obviously figured out how he can do this and get his car around this racetrack, and he's driving the wheels off of it.
Dale, when the race is over, it's going to be really interesting to see if that power steering is totally out or not. I agree with you. I don't think it's totally out. I think it might be, you know, intermittent for him. It's coming and going, you know, because he's so aggressive right now. He's got that thing in the bottom of the track and being really hustling, so makes me think.
Yeah, but it makes for a lot better story saying it's all the way out. He's doing a great job here, so let's go with that.
Let's go with that. The heck yeah, buddy.
Well, Dale's understanding this TV stuff in a hurry, okay? Here's the 17 car, by the way, who won this race a year ago. Okay, Kyle Busch is the leader. Kenseth in second spot. Boyer is back in third. And by the way, his teammate Scott Wimmer in the 29 car is back in fourth position. And folks, we told you that a week ago, Carl Edwards won the driver's points title. And today, the 29 car could walk away with the owner's championship. They have to be 196 points ahead. And right now, they're 203 up. And why is it important to be able to win the owner's championship? What are the benefits of being the owner's champion in the NASCAR Busch Series?
Now, take a look at this garage priority. You get the number one parking spot in the garage when you're the champion. The points fund, a lot of money in a points fund. And, you know, you get, you know, a lot of money, like we said. But, you know, the thing I like so much, guys, is that, you know, if you do have a rainout, you start to race by the owner's points. And there's all in the top 30. You're guaranteed in the race all the time if you're up there. So these owner points are very important.
All that stuff sounds great, but it's neat to have that truck parked in that number one spot in that garage all year long, and that's what you get.
I totally agree with you. You drive up there, and there's your truck. Number one parking spot. You get a little extra step in you when that happens, that's for sure.
Kenseth just absolutely sniffing the lead underneath the five car. Kyle Busch has led three times for 94 laps. So, folks, for the eighth time this year, Kyle Busch will lead the most laps. But will he go to victory lane again?
Guys, you just got to believe if Matt Kenseth can get in front of Kyle Busch, that clean air is going to make his car handle better. And as close as he's running right now, it looks like he should be able to check out on Kyle Busch if he can get in front of him, because aerodynamics is so big here, it's unreal.
More on the five car with Shannon.
Well, as you guys were saying, Kyle Busch has certainly led a lot of laps in this Busch Series this season. Last weekend, he was very frustrated with the second place finish back in Texas. After the race, Kyle just said, as Matt Kenseth is looking in, trying to make the pass, Kyle said his emotions just get the best of him at sometimes. He really wants to win a race. He actually said, I've had 10 wins in my career in the Busch Series. I have 9 seconds. So he obviously wants to win today, and he's going to fight until he does. Guys?
Well, here's another fellow right now, Matt Kenseth, Shannon. He's, you know, this reminds me of the duel they had last weekend with Jimmy Johnson, where Jimmy passed him right at the late stages of the race. You know, Matt doesn't want to finish second again, Andy. He wants to get this thing done. He wants to win it. He's tired of finishing second himself.
Matt's not planning on running second. He's stalking this five car. He's making his plans, and he's got a better race car. I predict that he is going to beat this five car somewhere or another. He's going to find a way around.
These guys have battled before in the late laps. In fact, it's been interesting to watch. 32 laps to go. Kyle Busch and Matt Kenseth. Remember the Kansas Speedway battle down the wire. Kenseth trying to get there. Kyle Busch trying to get there. What a finish in the heartland as they almost come together on the apron, but Kyle Busch would take the win. Can he hold on? We'll find out when we come back to Phoenix in just a moment. Our NASCAR Busch Series action at Phoenix is being brought to you by Robestus, the best in brakes. Well, we put the brakes on the competition here just for a moment because we are under caution for the ninth time today. High above Phoenix International Raceway, you see the 42 car, Dario Franchitti, minus some of the rear sheet metal. That big hole in the back of the car, that's where it lays on the racetrack right now. It's lying out on the track, and that's what brought out the caution flag debris on the track. Maybe this near tap from the 88 car earlier might have had something to do with it.
It could have knocked it loose here. I think he already had some damage on the right side, but Brad Keselowski helped maybe loosen that rear bumper up, and the wind finished it off.
How good was Tony Raines getting by there? Oh, there, let's see, there it comes off on the racetrack, and this sails out up and lands right in the middle of the groove. All right, how about the guys up front, the five-car crew chief? Let's go down to the pits in Shannon's Bank.
That's right, Kyle Busch, your race leader. Crew chief Alan Gustafson starting to look a little bit like Kansas with Matt Kenseth and Kyle Busch going for the lead. Can you guys hold Matt Kenseth off to get this win?
Well, we hope it looks a lot like Kansas after 200 laps here. He's stay green at Lowe's guys, did a really good job. I want to thank all the Busch guys that work on this car, Mike Bumgarner and all those guys that take care of this car for us and do a really good job. Happy for the pit crew. Had a good stop there, got us out first. So it's going to be fun. You know, Matt's really tough. He's a really good competitor. So hopefully it'll be just like Kansas. We'll get another trophy.
Now, you guys had a great restart, but Matt's really gaining on you guys. What is Kyle saying about the car right now?
It's pretty good. You know, I mean, Matt's coming, and, you know, you don't know how hard he's pushing. I don't know how much Kyle's saving. A little cat and mouse out there, but it'll be a fun last end of the race.
Well, hopefully you'll be the winner of that cat and mouse. Over to Mike.
Well, Shannon, one guy who was really looking forward to this caution and really is enjoying it, Matt Kenseth, he needed a break. Let's listen in.
Very all right on balance. Getting a little bit tight in the middle, but I'm also just waiting. My steering got so bad I can just both hands all I have to turn it, so I just kind of slow down there, hoping for a caution. Hopefully it'll cool it down again.
Now, Doc, I think the only question is this enough of a break to give Matt Kenseth a breather so he has something to challenge for this win?
Mike, let me ask the experts up here, what do you think? I know you heard he sounds fatigued. Is this enough of a break for him to be able to get a second win?
Well, that's a good question for Rusty. I know I've never driven a race without power steering, at least a long race. I've driven a late model race one time without it, and I know what that's like, but this is a little different.
Well, guys, you got to believe what he's saying. He said, hey, it's getting hard to turn out here. I'm about wore out. He needed a break to kind of, you know, let that blood start flowing again and just kind of get some strength back. So, but take a look at him here. He's really warming the tires up, trying to keep the debris off of it. And this is something he feels like he needs to do if he's going to have a shot to beat Kyle Busch, because you don't want that rubber getting built up in the tires. That if he slides down the corner, that thing will slide all over the place if he doesn't get it off. So the tough part is, this is really killing his arms doing this.
They had a shootout at Kansas City. We'll see if it can get happens again at Kansas. It was a 17 chasing the 5, and he just couldn't quite get there. Let's find out what happens here the final 25 laps at Phoenix.
Looks like Matt's car slid up the racetrack just a little bit. Let Kyle get away from by maybe a half a car length. Not too bad. Matt's really hanging in there still. Now he's just got to get that rubber build up off those tires, kind of get back in his rhythm and put a bullseye in the back of him. Try again.
Kevin Harvick, the 21 car, running in fifth position, goes around Kyle Kriseloff, one of the lap cars. Look at the glare. How hard is it to see they're going into one?
Boy, Kevin Harvick told us he wasn't having a problem, but, you know, there's a part on the racetrack right now where the sun's coming down, and they're really starting to struggle just a little bit on the front straightaway with that problem right now, guys.
Right in front of Harvick, the 29 of Wimmer. Here's a group 88 to see the Keselowski there, 33. Good run for Tony Raines. There's the new champion, Carl Evers, in the 60 car, back behind the 9 of Kane. That is 8th, 9th, 10th, and 11th.
Well, Carl Evers got a big run on the outside of that racetrack. This groove is getting wider and wider, and these drivers are starting to use more of the racetrack than they did earlier. So you can see Carl Evers got a lot of big. He got a big run on the top because of that.
David Reagan, leading Rookie of the Year contender back there in the 6th car. You see, this is the 99 car of Rudiman in 8th position. As Kane tries to go by and take the 8th spot away.
We got 22 laps to go in this race, guys. I got a feeling they're going to start getting a little nervous. They want to get some of these lap cars out of the way. Get up to the front. Whoa, look at this gaggle of cars down the back straightaway. 3 and 4 wide. Coming to the tri-oval in the back straightaway.
Oh, we got some guys getting together right through the dog leg.
You can feel the tension starting to heat up now, Andy. These guys are getting impatient, very impatient. They want to get it done.
Mike Wallace and the Geico Chevy now trying to hold his position as J.J. Gailey goes by in the 1 car.
That's his teammate right there. You can see the front tires going back and forth on that 1 car, chasing that thing. You see them get together right here. Wow.
Well, it's contact.
Guys are chasing hard.
They're 20th and 21st. Here goes Stephen Lightbine, the 90 car, trying to take the 21st spot away.
And talking about losing your rhythm, you saw Mike Wallace try to pass J.J. Gailey. When they touched, he had to get out of the throttle. 2 cars passed him on the outside, and that's what happens when you got to check up.
Stephen Light in the 90 car. Remember trying to get a ride for 2008. The young man who won at Kentucky, looking to try to find something to jump into for 2008. We talked to Stephen Light about the importance of what happened this year, maybe looking for a ride in 2008.
I almost feel like I'm contending for my job. At the same time, I'm trying to run well for the team I'm with. You obviously want to, the last impression you leave at the end of the year is going to be on all these team owners' minds. So you got to go out there and try to put it aside, the fact that you don't have anything secure for next year, the fact that you are leaving, and the fact that you don't have a job. You got to go out there and not think about it and race. And sometimes that's hard to do. It's definitely in the back of your mind.
Car in the wall here.
And the 22 car, Mike Bliss, got in the wall pretty hard there, Andy. He had a great run going throughout the day. And look at this, the back of the car all bent up. Can't see out of the back of it. The right front fender ripped off of it. And it looks like maybe the right front wheel has got a lot of toe out in it. So his team's going to have to work on this.
He's hit something. We heard him say that they had some brake issues earlier. So I don't know if that was a part of this accident or
right,
not.
Take
or
it behind the wall. Take
the
it
brakes.
Behind the wall.
Oh, man, you don't want to hear that. You hear that? Take it behind the wall. Ruined a good day he had going on.
Had a great day going after finishing second in Memphis. I'll show you again, love. You see from the back of the 20 car, Hamlin, you see the 22 up against the concrete.
That definitely could have been a brake issue because it looked like he got in that corner too hot, went up out of the groove, and that's where he lost.
Yeah, he sure did. I mean,
just go away. No brake. Yeah, they went clear to the floor.
Well, that kind of confirms that theory. Just tough break for the 22.
Well, that was a good theory, buddy. I mean, yeah, absolutely a brake problem. And folks, 160 miles an hour going to turn 3, and you hit the brake pedal and nothing happens. That's the old heck factor right there. Oh, my gosh.
Yeah, then after your heart starts back, then you start trying to save it. That pedal going to the floor going that fast will really get your attention.
Well, we've been able to show you throughout the year what happens when something breaks, when we have a part or a piece break. You know, and how do we do that? We do it because we have a special building, sort of a mobile TV studio that has all the parts and pieces of a race shop. We call it the ESPN Dish Tech Center.
Welcome to ESPN's NASCAR Dish Tech Center.
The Tech Center is an expando truck that travels with NASCAR and is actually a working television studio.
What they were doing was showing a cutaway car, but it was out in the parking lot. It was exposed to the weather.
We could actually do it inside the truck. We wouldn't have to worry about weather. We wouldn't have to worry about dirt. We wouldn't have to worry about the noise that's outside on a track.
ESPN worked with marketing agency Jack Morton Worldwide to create a technical studio that could travel from track to track for 38 straight weekends. Finding a way to creatively light the mobile studio was a challenge.
The current way of lighting would be to use fluorescent light boxes, so we would need at least a foot or 18 inches along the walls.
We actually came up with these light panels that are very, very thin, so we could keep the profile of the light boxes very, very narrow. And they're state of the art.
Another cutting-edge feature in the Tech Center is a three-dimensional touchscreen that gives fans a unique look at the inner workings of a racing engine.
Our computer department came up with a program where you take an engine and through touchscreen and animation, it actually comes toward you in 3D. It really takes it to a new perspective.
The Tech Center was built to accommodate two full-scale cutaway cars.
There's not much room inside of this trailer, and we needed to get a car to completely spin around.
So we had to create these special platforms that actually the cars roll onto, and then they can actually be jacked up, and then they can come down and they can roll around.
In addition to the cutaway cars, the Tech Center's equipped with enough car parts to fill up an entire garage.
Everything that we had on the transporters in the garage area when I pulled in, I've got right here in the Tech Center.
It's very flexible. You could shoot this from any angle. Tim Brewer, he wants to be able to set something up quickly, go live, and then move on to something else.
By the time we got it on site and people came in and saw it for the first time, the reaction was just, you know, kind of blew me away.
Once other people see this, they're going to want something similar because it's cool. It's got that cool aspect to it.
This could possibly be the way TV ends up going down the line. It's sort of fascinating to be able to have something that you can actually do on the road, and it looks fantastic.
You take a cutting-edge idea and add a lot of creative people, and you end up with the ESPN Dish Tech Center. What a novel way to be able to show the race fans at home all the parts and pieces inside, how it breaks down exactly up close and personal. Getting set for the restart here in the final lap. 16 laps to go. Can Kyle Busch hang on? How about Kenseth? How much energy does he have left in those arms? Can Bowyer get there? Remember, he dominated here in the spring in the 29 car, trying to hold on with Wimmer, former winner here, by the way, and win that owner's title.
Well, it looks like Kyle Busch got another great restart, guys. Time after time, he keeps getting these good starts on Clint, on Matt Kenseth, and that's just what you got to do. He's not making any mistakes right now.
I have to believe these late cautions are playing in the favor of Kyle Busch because of that very fact. He's been able to get out front on these restarts and get some distance. Then Matt's able to run him back down, but now we've only got 15 laps to go.
Yeah, you saw Matt Kenseth that last time get really high on the racetrack, and Clint Bowyer poked his nose on the bottom of the racetrack and trying to pass him right there. So, hey, this thing isn't over yet. Bowyer's got a fast car, guys.
I think it takes Matt Kenseth just a little while to kind of get in a rhythm because of that power steering issue he's got and try to, you know, figure out how he's going to steer the car to get there.
I totally agree with you, Andy. That's exactly what's happening right now. If he sails in the corner real deep, I mean, just really got to be killing his arms. And DJ, I mean, you got to hand it to Kenseth. He's manhandling this thing right now.
He's doing a great job. And, you know, I think he's found that maybe if he keeps his car up high, he doesn't have to turn it as hard and it's not working him as much. Plus, it's not hurting his tires. I think as he runs on the bottom, he abuses his tires a little bit. He's seen Kyle Busch stay up a little bit higher. And I think that's going to make it difficult for Matt Kenseth to make the pass. Kyle seems to have that high line really working. He's keeping a lot of momentum. And he has a tremendous amount of forward bite. And those restarts you were talking about, very impressed with Kyle Busch. He hammers that throttle and keeps the car going straight. If he ever decides he doesn't want to do this, I think he could go drag racing too.
Well, he looked awful good. You know, he won the truck race last night here, so that gave him a little experience on these restarts. It's got to help him here tonight too.
Hey, DJ, how about the weekend schedule for Kyle Busch? Well, by the way, here's the sixth car. Just slid up a little bit and lost some time. He'll lose a couple of spots. David Reagan.
Inside here. Inside.
We'll show you what happened to Reagan here in a gaggle of cars. Oh, up, sideways, just hanging on.
Now, Andy, this looks like another car that maybe locked the rear brakes up a little bit going at the corner and slid up. He just didn't lose it. Let's watch it again.
Well, he sure got loose getting in the corner. Real lucky they didn't back the car in the wall. Could have been the mud.
Back up to Kyle Busch here up front. And we talk about doing double duty. How about triple duty? Kyle Busch won the NASCAR Craftsman Truck race last night. He's running Busch. And by the way, when this race is over, he's jumping on a plane and flying to Las Vegas to run a late model stock car race tonight, where he grew up at Las Vegas' short track there, Las Vegas Motor Speedway. And oh, yeah, he'll come back. He's a part of the chase. He'll run the NASCAR Nextel Cup race here on Sunday.
That's a racer for you right there. You got to admire this kid. He really loves to drive these cars.
Yeah, there's no substitute for youth. I tell you, being 50 years old sitting here made me tired listening to Jerry talk about all of that. But, you know, he is a great race car driver. He's proven he can get into anything and win. And when it's like that and you can get in good equipment, you just want to race all the time.
You can see all these three right here, the 88 car, Keselowski, J.J. Yeley, McMurray. All three of these guys were involved in that accident early on. Looks like they've recovered. They're back at it, duking it out, and roughing each other up again. Nine laps to go. Patience is running out.
How about our newly crowned NASCAR Busch Series champion, Carl Edwards? By the way, he's the pole sitter for the Cup race here on Sunday. Edwards being shown in the eighth position.
He's having a pretty steady race throughout the day. He's showed signs of a lot of speed. The car looks like it's been just a little bit inconsistent today, but not too bad. He's been in the top 10 throughout the day.
Ron Hornaday stalking him back there, too, in that 77 car. He's got a little fresher tires. When he pitted there after these other guys had made their last stop, he stopped and got tires and was making it work for him.
Well, Kenseth's going to have to do something big time to pass Kyle Busch. He's going to have to maybe drive in, turn three pretty deep, get up high in the racetrack, maybe dime in the corner and come down to try to get underneath them. Something innovative he's going to have to use, because right now it's not working what he's doing.
And how about talking about young drivers in the future of this series? How about young Michael McDowell making his, he made his NASCAR Busch Series debut last week at Texas, finished 20th in the double zero, having a good run here driving for Michael Waltrip.
Yeah, he's doing a good job. That could easily right there have been a pretty good crash. Or he really stacked up big time, got out of the throttle, held on to it, didn't wreck it, did a good job.
Here goes Wimmer running down his two car, his teammate.
He can't make any mistakes right now, guys. He can lock this owner's championship up. He brings this thing home clean. Gets a little too aggressive. Gets in a crash with his teammate. That's not going to work. It's not going to work with car owner Richard Childress either if that happens.
I think these boys will play fair. They're not going to get into each other. They're going to race hard.
All three of the R cars right together, third, fourth, and fifth. Boyer, Wimmer, and Harvick. The two-car Boyer, 29 is Wimmer, and the 21 is Harvick.
Well, that's amazing, guys, to see all the team cars bumper to bumper. Look how close they're running. The lap times just then on the last lap are almost identical. And, you know, Richard's got to love how close they're running, but I know he'd love it a lot better if they were up front leading.
If not for these two cars up front, this 5 and 17, those guys will be having a great day.
And they use a lot of brake right here, guys. You saw some of the cars coming down the front straight when they hit the brakes. The noses really dive on them. And Andy, that really plays a toll on the brakes. We've seen a lot of brake problems today. This is a tough track. We'll probably see some tomorrow in the NASCAR Nextel Cup race.
Dominant performance by that driver right there, Kyle Busch.
I really think that the 17 car Matt Kenseth has the best car. I think this power steering issue is what's keeping him from making this pass and being able to get this win. I think that's the only thing holding him back.
Well, right now he's just probably wore out. He just wants to get it done.
Whoa, car spinning. They got a number of cars involved. Frank Keating's involved. David Reagan's involved. The 30 car is also there. Stanton Barron.
Wow, the 25 car, Richard Johns, has almost got through every wreck today, and he got tangled up in this one. Too bad. He's been doing a great job throughout the day. And another crash right at the start finish line, literally. There it is, folks, right on your screen.
Yeah, Richard Johns done a heck of a job. He's dodged three different crashes today. Stanton Barrett, who was having a good run in his 30 car, he's involved, and he will not finish. We will end up with a green, white, and checkered situation. Dario Franchitti, who, despite getting tapped from behind, was spun 360 and avoided contact. Now his car involved, and he was nosed into the inside wall. Take a look at how this happened looking back out of the 25 car for Richard Johns.
looks like Dario Franchitti got in the back of Richard Johns. Spun him. They all started piling up. Just a little bit too aggressive on the throttle by Dario. And this is what happens when it's all over. Piled up at the start-finish line.
See Reagan involved there with the 30. It was David Reagan that got Stanton Barrett as he was trying to slow up.
Yeah, those guys were just trying to avoid this wreck and end up getting smack in the middle of it.
Right along with David Reagan, and watch what he saw.
He's just minding his own business coming off the corner.
And boy, when those guys check up in front of you that quickly, you just can't get stopped. And look at the sunlight.
Up here if you can.
It's another sunlight problem. Man, you got a feel for Richard Johns. He has a good wave to the crowd.
They will put the red flag out again with three laps to go and try to get this race. They will get this race restarted. There's the heavy damage on Dario Franchitti's car.
They had to red flag the race because this is basically is blocking the racetrack right here at start finish line, and they need to clean this mess up. And it's hard to do that when you got race cars going by or trying to get by this mess.
David Reagan in the sixth car. Reagan, by the way, fifth in the point standings. Remember, we talked about the NASCAR Busch Series only drivers who are regulars trying to get up there. Reagan, who runs both Busch and Cup. But the point's pretty tight there from sixth on down through 11th, so some things could shuffle here in the final couple of events.
Well, it gives everybody time to cool off and get themselves ready to go for a big shootout right here. We could have another caution, guys. This is going to be a gunfight.
Let's give Matt Kenseth the chance to rest those arms a little. Maybe he can go after this five car.
And we are in the Southwest. That's why they use guns out here, right? Back in Old West.
Let's go down and check in with Mike Massaro.
And guys, you're right. It gives the 17 new life and an opportunity to challenge for this win. Do you have anything for the five?
You know, I think we might be a tick better than Kyle right now. The problem is you got to be better than just a tick better to win here at Phoenix. Kyle's a heck of a driver, so we're going to have our hands full, I think.
Got a good car, but I would imagine a tired driver. How's the lack of power steering affecting Matt?
Honestly, the cautions and the red flags help it. Whatever problem we're having seems to redeem itself every time it cools off. So the Arby's Fusion should be good to go here for green white checker.
Well, Matt Kenseth might win this race, but I don't think he could win an arm wrestling match at the end of this one, Doc.
Yeah, absolutely. What a job Matt Kenseth has done today. I got to believe his forearms are going to be pulsating when this day is over after holding on to the steering wheel. But you know what? That's why you guys work so hard to stay in shape.
You know, it really is. But, boy, this is a great feel for a driver who's sitting second or third to know that maybe he's got another shot at victory lane. This guy's got to love it. Take a look at Alan Guthis and his crew chief. He's probably a box of nerves right now thinking, I cannot believe this thing just went caution, red flag, thought we had it locked up. Now we got to race for it again.
It seems like, you know, when you've got the lead, it takes forever to get to the finish, especially when you have these cautions at the end and you're thinking, well, this thing ever end, man.
Well, sun is setting above Phoenix International Raceway. Could the sun be setting on Kyle Busch in the Hendrick car, maybe getting his final win there in a Busch car? Aerial coverage brought to you courtesy of our good friends at Goodyear, the official tire of NASCAR, helping NASCAR drivers get to the finish line for over 50 years. And folks, we're going to be right back here tomorrow afternoon, 3 o'clock Eastern time. NASCAR Nextel Cup chase for the championship continues. Phoenix International Raceway. Remember, Jeff Gordon won it here from the pole in the spring. Jimmy Johnson finished back in fourth position. Folks, if Gordon were to win it again and Johnson finished fourth, guess what? Jeff Gordon would retake the points lead. That's how close it is, just 30 points separating the top two. We'll have all the coverage here from Phoenix tomorrow at 3 o'clock. And by the way, Carl Edwards, the new pole sitter, the pole sitter for the first time this year in NASCAR Nextel Cup, will lead him down alongside Martin Truex Jr. And talking about a guy who's got a lot at stake, not only tomorrow, but how about today, maybe getting a win for the five car. Let's go down where Dave is caught up with a car owner, Rick Henry.
Yep, with Rick up here, Doc. And, you know, they keep prolonging these on you. It seems like you're in position to win, and then you have to wait, Rick. Is that tough?
It is tough. You know, Matt's unbelievable. Kyle, you know, if I had to have a guy out front in one of these two-lap shootouts, it'd be Kyle Busch, but Matt has been awful good. He's tried everything, and Kyle's changed his lines to stay out front, and it's going to be a heck of a finish here. But I hate these green-white checkers.
Can you tell me what it means to the organization? These guys have been close a lot this year. They've won a lot this year. Kyle is finishing up with your group. How important is it for them to do well these last couple races?
Well, you know, they have had a heck of a year, both on the Busch side and the Cup side. And, you know, they've been so close, and we've had little things happen. He's run second so many times, won three. So this would be a great one to win. He won the truck race last night. So these guys work hard, Mike Bumgardner and Allen. All of the guys just put in a tremendous amount of effort. He's led a bunch of laps this year, and he's a heck of a shoe. So hopefully we can get the trophy here this afternoon.
Well, it's been a good run for Kyle. Last Busch race today. Two more Cup races for this man right here, Rick Hendrick.
And what about Rick Hendrick? Only in America, the rags-to-riches story of Rick Hendrick growing up in a small town in Virginia, a life filled with triumph and tragedy, losing his son and brother and nieces and some of his closest friends in motorsports in a tragic plane crash a few years ago on the morning of a race in Martinsville, Virginia. And what he has done, he and his wife Linda, this whole organization, to bounce back and have two drivers in contention tomorrow for a NASCAR Nextel Cup title, but also to be able to lead this organization in the NASCAR Busch Series. I mean, what a respect, probably no more respected owner in the garage area than that man right there, Rick Hendrick. Well, the Busch season's been awfully tough for the 5 car for Kyle Busch. Remember, he had some struggles early in the year, thought he had a win coming on. The tight finish in Vegas on the final lap, and it wasn't to be. Burton took the pass, and Kyle Busch hit the wall. How about the lug nut issues at Atlanta when he had probably the best car in the field, but no, they had to come back on pit road and put lug nuts. In Bristol, Tennessee, Thunder Valley, a couple times he gets tagged from behind and spins it around when he might have had the best car there. And how about Talladega on your roof at 190 miles an hour? Kyle Busch spinning as cars go sailing by, and he finally tumbles side over side and comes to rest. What a difficult, difficult year. And how truly appropriate would it be for Kyle Busch and his 5 team, after all they've had to overcome, to maybe get a win here in what will be his final start for Hendrick Motorsports.
And boy, he's going to go short track racing in Las Vegas, you said, guys, after this race is over. How's it going to be when he goes there and they say, hey, how'd you do today? Well, hey, I won, man. That really does make you feel good when you get in those planes and go to those little short tracks like a lot of these fellas up and down pit road have done.
Yeah, he won the truck race here last night. He may hang on and win the Busch race. And, folks, that'd be pretty good if you could sweep all three here in a weekend at Phoenix. Why don't we head down to our countdown studio with Alan Bestwick, Dale Jarrett, and Brad Daugherty. Guys?
And Doc, following up on a couple things we started this Busch Series race talking about, the big four, if you will, Clint Bowyer, Carl Edwards, Matt Kenseth, and Denny Hamlin. Three of them have been in contention to win the race today. Hamlin with his mechanical problems earlier, and it's Kyle Busch who's been the star of the show so far, Brad.
Yeah, Kyle, he's had such a good year. We talk about his struggles, but he's also won three races. He's led a ton of laps, probably should have won about five more races, but he's had a great year.
Yeah, every one of those things that we saw a while ago where they were having problems, he was up front when they had those problems. So just a great job, and he does a terrific job behind the wheel of the race
and
car.
Lost a couple of races by this much earlier. Let's turn our attention to tomorrow just a little bit. Two races left to go to settle the NASCAR Nextel Cup Series Championship. Jimmy Johnson, Jeff Gordon, separated by 30 points. That could be as few as 5 finishing positions in the rundown tomorrow. Both qualified well. Jeff Gordon will start third, and Jimmy Johnson will take the green flag in 6th position. We were watching final practice earlier today. Did we get any clues about tomorrow's race from watching that? DJ?
Well, go ahead, DJ.
Yeah, I think that the clue is that they're both going to be there whenever everything shakes out tomorrow. Obviously, both teams have performed extremely well all year long. But I'd have to say that as good as Jimmy Johnson and Chad Knaus have been here over the last 10 races in particular, Jeff Gordon's going to be hard to beat here. He likes this racetrack. He has just a terrific record here, and I think he realizes what his job is. And when you put Jeff Gordon in that position, you're going to have a hard time beating him.
Yeah, I watched like the last 10, 12 laps of practice where Jimmy Johnson, he got out on Jeff Gordon's tail, and he ran pace for pace for him. And they were hitting different spots on the racetrack, running side by side. And I think he was sizing up the competition. I think Jimmy knows he's going to have to beat Jeff tomorrow. I think Jeff bounces back. And this is a great place for him. Just like DJ said, I think Jeff Gordon's going to be up front tomorrow.
I still maintain this championship between those two guys is decided by a flat tire.
Oh, I agree.
Somewhere in these final two races. Yeah. By the way, Doc, our stat guys have been crunching this number. This is the fifth time in the last nine NASCAR Busch Series races we've seen a red flag in the late going.
Good number. And how about the fact that in the green-white checkered, the last three times we've had them, Kyle Busch has been the guy leading him down to the green-white checkered flag. And we saw what happened at Las Vegas early in the year.
Well, he's probably learned something from all the times that he's done it. And we've seen how good he gets off the green. Every time, every restart we've had today, that car is just launched out there. So I got to think that this is an advantage for Kyle Busch, even though that 17's hungry.
Well, you got to believe that Matt Kenseth has learned something also. I mean, he's had restart after restart and can't seem to get to Kyle Busch, but now he's cooling the tires down. He's sitting there thinking about it, going, you know what? I got one shot left and I got to get it right. He's either going to sail around the outside of him and try it on the top side, or get down on the bottom and try to rough it up. Or you know what, Jerry? That five might just get another big-time restart and drive off from everybody.
Well, we're going to wait on that finish. I got one comment about tomorrow, guys. Are we talking about how good Jeff Gordon is? I got to believe Jeff Gordon is going to come into this race tomorrow swinging a big stick. I believe he's going to come here and try to open up a can on some of these guys and take that points lead back going into Homestead.
He's going to come out. I think he is going to be the guy to beat tomorrow. I really do. But, you know, that 48 car, Chad Knaus, those guys have been able to mount something here. I mean, their momentum is so strong. I'm not sure that he can put enough distance tomorrow to take that point lead, but I think that Jeff Gordon might make a dent in it.
Boy, it should be fun to watch. I can't wait. 3 o'clock Eastern time, folks, on ABC, our coverage of the NASCAR Nextel Cup Series Chase. Now, while we're under the red flag, why don't we visit with our in-race reporter, Kevin Harvick.
Kevin Harvick, Rusty Wallace, ESPN. You got us, buddy?
Oh, Rusty, go ahead.
All right, man. We got anything left for him? I think everybody's probably cooling down, thinking about it. You got something?
We've got tight here, right in the middle of the corner, and I thought we had it fixed, and then we got that last red, and after that last red, it got really tight again for some reason. So we'll see what happens here. We don't give up. We're gonna keep racing hard and have fun with it.
Well, buddy, I know you. You're one hard driver, and I believe you can probably get you some positions if these guys have a problem in the front, and the tension's heating up right now.
Yeah, we just got to make sure we take care of our teammates here in front of us. And, you know, you never know what's going to happen in front of that.
All right, buddy. We'll talk to you later.
Three laps to go here at Phoenix, and we're going to see what's going to happen here. Pace car fires back up and pulls away. Kyle Busch trying to hold on and get the win. All the tumultuous season has been for Kyle Busch. He's a three-time winner here, has 10 career Busch Series wins. He won at Daytona, he won at Richmond, and he won at Kansas.
Jerry, this is hope for a lot of the guys. They all want this last shot at Kyle Busch. They think that something might happen. The crew chiefs are telling them, hey, Kevin Harvick, you can probably get it done. The five car to 17 might wreck. Clint Boyer's thinking he can slide through. I remember when I was a driver, I would think the same thing. It's not over till it's over, Andy, because these guys can wreck, and all of a sudden, you could be the winner.
That's right. If you're anywhere that you can see the leader, you got a shot on a green-white checkered.
This will be the seventh green-white checkered flag run of the year in the NASCAR Busch Series. It'll be the eighth. There have been seven thus far. There's the 88 car, Keselowski, coming in for four fresh good years. We'll see what that'll do for him in these final laps.
It'll help a lot, but he only got a lap, really a lap and a half, two laps of racing to do anything with it. So I don't think he's going to be able to do anything but maybe get a spot or two.
Yeah, he's the last guy on the lead lap. And so these four tires, if he drives real aggressive like he's probably going to, he might be able to pick up three or four positions. And that's worth it, the points.
Twice this year we've seen passes on the last lap. We showed you the one that Jeff Burton made on Kyle Busch at Las Vegas. Bobby Labonte made one on Tony Stewart at Talladega to take the win. Can Kyle Busch hold on? You know that 17 car, he's going to say, you know, what the heck, guys? I got one shot. I got passed at Texas last week, so now it's my turn.
One thing, too, though, these guys have been sitting still for a while. It's cooled off a lot. These tires have all cooled down, and the pressures have come down again. So now these guys have got some low air pressures, maybe some buildup. Could get kind of crazy right here.
And that's a great point. Look how low the left front tire is, and that does not create grip, you know. So this could be a real tough deal to hold on to for two laps here.
Speaking of tough deals, the 88 car, Brad Keselowski, is going to have to come back on the pit road because they're missing a lug nut. They're going to have to come back in and put a lug nut on, and that's going to certainly cost him big time.
He was already the last guy on the lead lap after making that pit stop, and just getting one to go, he'll be able to line back up just about where he is.
Yeah, Jerry, that's the only thing saving him right now. Just like Andy said, he's going to be on the outside at the very back of the pack, still be able to fix a lug nut and not hurt him.
Let's go down to Jamie.
Well, Doc, Mike Dillon, spotter for Clint Bowyer, just got a call on his cell phone as I was standing next to him that said Clint Bowyer must let the 29 of Scott Wimmer by in order for them to clinch. Now, the two of them, he's standing with Richard Childress, owner, right now. They're trying to figure out if that is the case. They don't want to call down to their drivers team orders unless it is a fact. So they're trying to work it out. We're going to have to watch and see if it unfolds here on this green-white checker. Doc?
And, Jamie, what happened was that wreck just a moment ago involving those four cars that were between in front of the 20 car of Hamlin, who's to take the car they got to beat, has created this issue here. Remember, they got to leave here with a 196-point lead in the owner's points to clinch. And right now we're showing right at 200, so it's really, really close here what happens on this restart, the final three laps, whether Richard Childress will walk away as the owner's champion.
I just don't like that. I don't like this team order business and giving spots to people. I think you got to just race it on the racetrack.
I think you got to do the same thing, race it on the track. But it looks like Richard's wanting a little bit of insurance right now to make sure that he does have this thing locked up. He doesn't want to take this fight all the way to Homestead.
All right, here we go. Kyle Busch, can he hang on? How about Kenseth? Can he get there? Tire pressure's down. Pressure of the drivers up. Green flag.
And boy, another great restart for Kyle Busch. He was shot out of there like a cannon, and he is gone right now.
Down the back straightaway, Kyle Busch pulls him by five car lengths. Make it six car lengths.
And will Clint Bowyer let Scott Wimmer by to pick up that extra position? It doesn't look like that's going to happen at the moment, guys.
Kevin Moss waving the white flag to Kyle Busch. One more lap to victory.
He's got a little bit of cushion off of turn two.
Yeah, he's actually at turn three right now with a lot of momentum. He's looking good right now, guys. Doesn't seem to be a problem for Kyle Busch. There's one more corner.
22-year-old Kyle Busch, he won the truck race here on Friday night. Can he pull it off two in a row? Kyle Busch comes out of turn four, and Kyle Busch will hold on and win his fourth Busch race of 2007.
Busch, there is opportunity. Appreciate all your guys' hard work and determination this year.
Boy, what a feel-good for that team. Kyle Busch so close so many times. He gets it out here at Phoenix, Arizona. Wins a truck race.
Unbelievable, buddy. You drove the wheels off of that thing. You sure deserve that one. Great job. Proud of you.
Yeah, that's Rick Hendrick, the car owner. How about the great job by Alan Gustafson and that whole crew in getting Kyle? And you heard Kyle thank him. There's Alan, the crew chief. A big smile from him. Dave.
And a lot of handshakes going around because this is the end of an era. Yeah. Kyle Busch, last Busch race, I guess is the way you should end it.
It is. It's appropriate. It's tough. Kyle's done a good job. These guys have done a good job. So we've got some tough breaks we had to work through. Just really proud of him. Never gave up, never fought, never lost faith in us. So real happy for him. He's a hell of a driver.
Yeah, you knew you had a talent every time you got behind that wheel, didn't you?
Yeah, it was a lot of fun. You know, the Busch stats are really impressive. Cup team's done a great job. Had a couple bad incidents there. We'd be racing Jimmy and Jeff for the points. So it's really been a good year. You know, sometimes you think it's bad, but when you win a race like this, can't be too bad.
All right, a little emotion in the voice and in the eyes of Alan Gustafson, Jamie.
Well, Dave, big day for them. A tough day for Richard Childress. We were talking about the idea whether or not Clint would need the driver to go by in order for you guys to clinch. You didn't clinch. Richard, what happened?
Well, we didn't know. You know, I thought they told us we only needed 16 positions, and we had 20. It isn't no big deal. You know, it's the guys were just racing. Clint would have moved over if we'd asked him. But we got next week. It's another week away, and we'll do it there.
Build the suspense for next week. They miss it by 2 points. We'll have to check back in with Richard Childress next weekend. Guys?
2 points, that's what we're being told. The differential between what would have given them an owner's championship here today. How about taking a look at our Crown Royal crowning moment of the race? Talk about great efforts. How about the restarts for Kyle Busch? He's been a jackrabbit all afternoon. And this was the most critical one of the night, the final race, final restart for Kyle Busch here in the final two laps.
Yeah, Kyle Busch just got another one. Just drove off right there. He's been doing it time after time, so this is no surprise, but that was Matt Kenseth's last chance. Didn't get it done.
Kyle Busch takes the win. Matt Kenseth finishes second. He's with Mike.
And Ironman Matt has just climbed from his race car. How are your arms?
That's funny.
Yeah, that's all right. We just, you know, would lose the steering wheel and get hot. It was something real odd going on. But it wasn't really that hard to turn. It just harder than normal, and you couldn't feel the front tires very good, so it was a little bit of a hindrance. But it was a great run for Arby's Fusion. I feel bad we got beat again this week. We just come up a little bit short. We're just a little off on front grip to the middle of the corner. And, you know, Kyle's in good stuff, and he's a great race car driver. He's real smart, knew where to put his car exactly in the right spot where I couldn't pass him. So it was a great job by him, and, you know, wish we were in victory lane. But it was a good race for us.
When it came down to that duel between yourself and the five, how much of a factor was not having the full capacity of your power steering?
It wasn't bad. That long green run was real bad. And then there wasn't really a factor. I just, in two laps, I couldn't get him. I think maybe with 15 laps, a 15-lap run toward the end, it seemed like we could make a little ground toward the end of the run. We might not have a shot, but it slowed us down a little bit, but it probably wasn't the difference between winning and losing.
Second place for Matt Kenseth, but Doc, he's got to be getting a little bit tired of this. The seventh time this year he's been the runner-up in a Busch Series race.
That means he's been there seven different times, though, Mike. It means he's been right there at the front in position to win a race, so give him his due. They've certainly had a great run. Kyle Busch, folks, led three times for 132 laps of the 203 we actually ran, and he becomes the ninth different winner of 12 here at Phoenix to start from the front two rows. Kyle Busch climbs out as we head down to victory lane in Shannon Spain.
That's right, guys. His last Busch race with Hendrick Motorsports, Kyle Busch goes to victory lane. Lots of emotions, lots of celebration down here. High fives to all of his team. Very emotional. Team owner Rick Hendrick. Kyle, this has been such an emotional season for this team. What does this win mean to you?
Oh, it means a lot. I mean, to get my start with Hendrick Motorsports and finish second in the first one and to go out winning a race, that's pretty special. You know, that means a whole lot. This is my 11th win, I guess it is, in a Busch Series. So, you know, it's all to these guys here. They work their hearts out and do as much as they can in the shop in order to prepare us and get us ready for here at the racetrack. And, you know, Stay Green, Spectracide, Lowe's, everybody that's been on board with us, helping us out. Great job by them, and thanks to Lowe's for sticking through me with, you know, the Busch Series year in 2004 where we went for the championship. Come up a little bit short, but, you know, winning's always fun.
You guys were great on restarts, but I got to ask you, what was going through your mind under that red flag?
Just that it reminded me so much of the past two other days here, you know, but I don't mind that. Hey!
All right, well, very emotional for Kyle Busch. We're going to let him go in about 5 hours, you guys. Kyle Busch is going to climb behind the wheel of a late model in Las Vegas and go at it again.
Three times he's been a part of a green-white checkered. All three times he's been the man that goes to victory lane. Great job for Kyle Busch, 3 for 3. Don't forget to join us tomorrow here, folks, 3 o'clock Eastern time. NASCAR Nextel Cup chase for the championship. Our live flag-to-flag coverage. How about it? 30 points separating Jeff Gordon and Jimmy Johnson. Coming up next, ESPN2 College Football Scoreboard. This has been a presentation of ESPN, the worldwide leader in sports. Congratulations to Kyle, the winner at Phoenix. See you tomorrow, folks. So long from Phoenix.